Well, we are back, huh? We're back at the Nine Club, everybody. Listen, today we got a special guest. Mr. Chris Ray is with us, huh? Critically acclaimed cinematographer, won a bunch of awards, huh? Probably filmed your favorite skater, skate in a skate video.
Thanks for having me. I usually prefer to be behind the camera, but it's cool to be here.
This is great.
This is awesome.
This is great, yeah. Bro. So you and Raj, just go ahead and start talking.
Talk about megapixels, everything just, else.
Trust me, I'm sure that will get brought up.
So and we talk about a new red hydrogen you got here?
And yeah, Kelly and me will just not even say a word, you know. But no, thank you so much for coming, dude.
Yeah,
this is great, bro. You're doing DC now, GoPro.
Yeah, I mean, I do a lot of stuff with everybody, but mainly DC is what I'm at right now.
Okay.
Just been there the last 8 years. And
yeah, it's a good
been,
run.
Yeah. It's been good.
Yeah.
So managing their films department.
Okay.
Got brought in to kind of do like a lot of the skate stuff.
Yeah.
And then it's opened up to do really anything and everything. I mean, we have filmed
Ken Block. Did you film the guy riding across the water?
You know what I did? Actually, I did film that. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Whoa. I did film that with the crew that we have at DC. It's all skate filmers basically, and they had us go out to Tahiti for 3 weeks and film that. And basically, when Jeff Taylor came to us, he was like, "Look, we have this idea. We're going to film a guy ride a motorcycle on water and ride a wave, but I can't, I can't have a Hollywood production crew out there. I need skate filmers that are used to running any gun situation, mm-hmm. security getting kicked out and just getting it." And we went out there and treated it as if it was a skate session. And it was an amazing experience.
Did you get off the phone? Like you want me to film what?
Yeah. No, you know, I was,
the fuck are you talking
when he
about?
Asked us, I didn't think it was going to happen.
Okay.
And then when I met Robbie Madison, the guy, his work ethic was so incredible that I was like, okay.
He's going to pull it.
This is going to happen because this guy's going to make it happen.
So you guys just barged that. It was a whole, you didn't get permits or anything?
No, I mean, when you go to Tahiti, like you need to get, we had to hire some locals. We had the local guy there is like the surf legend.
Okay.
And he basically like gave us the okay and he kind of lined things up. But I mean, it wasn't cheap, but it was...
Sure.
Definitely a lot of trial and error while we were out there.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
but I mean,
sense.
Like, how many, like, if the motorcycle sinks, you have to have, like, a few on deck, right? You can't just restart the goddamn thing.
I think the initial goal is to have three out there.
Oh.
But we only had, like, a one and a half type thing because we had issues with customs, maybe. And
bring the bikes in?
Yeah, I mean, we brought a lot of stuff out there.
How do you have half a motorcycle?
you take it out there all taken apart.
Oh, you
And then the mechanic comes out and he puts it together.
How do they start it, though? Like,
so, you mean how does he, like, even get out on the water? Well, so...
Gotta have a running start.
So, we had, like, a barge that he basically rode off of the boat. And then and in Tahiti, there's this famous wave, Chopu, which breaks in the exact same spot every time.
Mm.
So Jeff Taylor's idea was like, hey, dude, if you ride it off of that and you time it with the wave, you'll be able to ride it, you know? So that's what they did. And I hadn't filmed any water sports of any sort. And I remember we were at like kind of like a little meeting with Robbie when he was out testing it at a lake. And he looked at me, he's like, hey, Chris, have you filmed water sports? And I was like, oh, that's such a weird, like, I never even had that question. I was like, yeah, totally.
Totally. So, I got this.
Yeah. So that was like myself and like the other guys at DC.
Playback was out there too.
Playback came out there, shot some photos. Martin Phobes, Sam Sanowski, Jay Benz.
Now, where were you? Were you on the beach?
No. So the wave breaks in the middle of the ocean. It's not at all near the shore.
Okay.
So we are actually on a boat and just trying to, you know, ride cameras, not get dunked in the water.
Right.
There was even one point when he got the first wave finally after like 3 weeks and he said, hey, there's a bigger wave coming. Will you guys stay for an extra few days and try to get that? And we tried to get that. And
I know the bigger wave's coming. Yeah.
Yeah.
Storm.
The swell or whatever.
Yeah. Bigger swell or something. Yeah, so
must have watched the news.
He wanted to go out to a different area and we couldn't film it from the boats. Mm. So they actually put me on a jet ski. So there's a guy on the front of a jet ski. I'm in the middle
with
a
red camera.
There's a photographer in the back, no water housing. And we're out in the middle of the ocean and I see Robbie coming, wave takes him out. I hear the guy say, hold on. And he just guns it. And the biggest wave is coming after us. And we just fly in the air, dip into the water. And I'm just covering the red camera, just trying not to get it soaked.
So,
yeah.
It's an expensive camera.
Yeah, those bodies aren't cheap.
How much is a red? We're talking. What kind of a camera? Because there's different types, right? There's red dragon.
Yeah, I mean, now they go
tiger.
Luckily, you can get them.
A bunch of them.
Luckily, you can get them. Red Bull for cheaper.
But I mean, like on average, if you want to go grab a red camera,
I'd say like $25,000 now.
Wow.
Yeah.
For the cheap one.
Well, let's talk about more about surfing and stuff.
That's like not even surfing.
This is great. I know, but I know, whatever. It's riding waves, you know?
I mean, Kelly, have you even seen it's called Pipe Dream. Have you even seen it?
I haven't seen it.
It's fucking...
Psycho. Okay.
There you go. It's psycho. Yeah. It is
I need to
fucking
see this.
Psycho,
it's cool.
Dude.
It's cool, man. Robbie's the man.
The one he did the airfield, too, was pretty rad.
Yeah, that wasn't... That was Justin Smith. I wasn't involved with that one, but that was rad, yeah.
Wait, so that was his first time doing that?
Doing the wave, yeah.
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 How did he just like ride it out?
He rode it, and then there was a landing, like basically a little boat with a little ramp onto it, and then he rode onto that. It's not like land to water to land. It was all planned out. And there's a whole like behind the scenes on YouTube that's called Behind the Dream. That's pretty interesting.
He didn't ride into shore.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. How big is the wave?
I don't know. It wasn't huge. Like, it wasn't like he was barreled.
Like a 4 foot.
Yeah, it was probably like 4 to 6 feet or something. Right, but it was still insane. Yeah,
regardless, he's on a fucking dirt bike.
Yeah,
in the water.
Oh no, 100%.
Yeah, I mean, dude, it was hands down one of the coolest things I've ever got to film.
I mean, but that's amazing though. You get to go and watch these fucking crazy shit happening, and you know,
it's because he was filming skateboarding.
Yeah.
I mean, dude, DC's definitely opened up a lot of opportunities to film other stuff. Mm-hmm. And when I first went there, I only knew how to film skating. I didn't know how to do an interview. I didn't know how to tell a story.
Oh, really? You weren't
I was just a skate filmer. I mean, like kids nowadays will come to me and they'll be like, "Hey, I want to intern for you. I want to work for you." And I always ask them, What do you want to do? And they say, your job. And I said, what do you think my job is? And they say, film skateboarding. I'm like, that's changed quite a bit in the last 10 years. Like, it's not just filming tricks.
Yeah, you tell stories now.
Stories, it's product, it's everything else.
And totally.
Luckily, you know, DC does a lot of rad stuff. So they're able to give me those opportunities of learning that and trusting me with that. So I'm stoked on that.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Let's bring it back.
Okay.
Let's bring it back to the younger Chris.
Okay.
It's weird saying my own name, by the way. It's just,
yeah,
it's I know
weird.
Your name is Chris too, but it's just weird.
It's weird saying it to you too.
Yeah. Yeah. You said you were born in Hawaii.
Yeah, I was born in Maui. My parents moved out there to party.
To party?
Yeah, they were with their friends in high school.
Mm. Were they pregnant? Was she pregnant at the time?
No,
they went out there to party.
I came from the party.
They partied hard and you came from the party.
Exactly, right. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You showed up to the party.
Showed up. I was the only blonde-haired white baby, blue eyes in the hospital. So, I was born in Maui, Hawaii.
But then you said you moved to Washington State.
Yeah, I moved to... My family is from Bremerton, Washington, which is right across from Seattle.
Okay.
So we went back there and lived there until I was in fifth grade. Mm-hmm. And then that's when my mom moved to Northern California, Concord, California.
Mm.
And that's where I got into skating, introduced to like the cool world of California.
How did you get introduced to skateboarding in California?
I pretended to be sick from school one day. And I would just remember being like at home and looking outside, and there was these two random kids, this guy and this girl, just skating in front of my parking lot in the apartment building.
Okay.
And I went out there and was talking to them, and
supposed to
be sick.
Why were you? Why was it? You had a test that day. What was going on?
I don't know what it was. I just think
some
I didn't
you
like
do
school.
That. You're just like, fuck, yeah,
I know,
today,
but
dude.
It was a big deal back then to just like, you know. Use that token, I guess.
How did you play sick? Now, were you a good fake sicker, or
yeah,
were you
I think
like...
I just said I don't feel good.
Okay.
But I met these kids, and they were rad. They were from Oregon, and they let me try their skateboards, and I was obsessed. But totally green to everything.
Yeah,
didn't
know for
anything.
Sure.
I mean, didn't know trick names, didn't know pro skaters, didn't have a clue. And then so I skated that whole summer by myself in that parking lot. Absolutely loved it.
Now, if you didn't have a clue, I mean... You were just going off of whatever you thought was like pushing, kneeboarding.
Yeah, I mean, they
didn't know what an ollie was. You didn't know anything.
No, I didn't know how to ollie. So they, and then they left. And my neighbor was like, oh, you like skateboarding. And I have one. So I would just go to his next door house and just borrow it.
Okay.
And eventually my parents were like, hey, we'll buy it from him. And the only thing they really taught me was to do like a slappy like board slide on a parking block.
Ooh.
So I just learned those. So you don't have to ollie. You can just lift up and slide it. And I did that. And then when I went to sixth grade, I remember telling my friends, like, hey, I skateboard. And my other friend's like, dude, so do I. And
oh, perfect.
We started getting all our other friends into it.
And then were you getting good? Did you want to like go after the sponsorship
no
route?
No idea that even existed yet.
At that time.
Right. No idea.
Well, you, funny, before the show, you had mentioned that the first video that you even knew existed was a 4-on-1 issue 17.
I was school shopping, and this was probably in sixth grade. Like sixth or seventh grade, and my aunt took me school shopping, and we went into a Zoomies, and I was looking around at clothes, and I looked over and I saw a skate video, and it was 4-on-1 issue 17, and I was like, a skate video? Like, people make skate videos?
Yeah.
Like, what? So my mind was blown. I mean, can you imagine not even knowing? But it was the same way I found out about Skateboard Magazine. I went to go get milk at a 7-Eleven for my mom, and I came back and I was like, they make a skateboard magazine called Thrasher.
Right.
I didn't know it existed. Can I go back and get it? So it was awesome to kind of find things out.
That's rad.
Like in a weird way. We're like, nowadays you can just find anything out instantly.
Instantly. You type in skateboarding.
Yeah. It was cool. Like getting my first skate video, I watched that thing every single day. I was obsessed with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Obsessed with it.
Now,
who had your favorite part in there?
I think it was the opening chaos. Yeah, the opening chaos. Ooh. And then King Gill and Jason Maxwell had like a shared part, and that was rad. And
okay.
I brought a copy, but I don't have the original. Yeah, it's back man Kelly, because he's the 4-on-1 dude. But I had bought that one recently on eBay just so I like had it. Just so I have the first copy.
Very nostalgic. Do you save a lot of shit? Because I mean, that's a little extensive to buy the first 4-on-1.
You know what? I saving a board from like everybody I did a part with when I worked at Trans World. I was doing that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And then saving things that like meant stuff from like premiere tickets, things like that.
Right.
But then, you know, I have a kid and it's just like my garage is filling up like it's just full of junk. And I'm like, dude, I don't want any of this anymore. So
you brought it all over here.
Brought it over here.
Fucking unloaded it.
Just leaving the red camera here. I'm like, don't need the stuff.
Hey, so when you first saw these videos back then, did you have any idea? Were you watching just the skating? Were you like, oh, that film's kind of cool too? Like, was that in your mind?
Dude, I was watching the skating because I wasn't exposed to, I guess, a lot of it yet. But it wasn't until I saw the Trans World videos, like Feedback and Modus, when that clicked that, wait a minute, this video is better than these other videos. You know what I mean? So when I saw those videos, I was like, wait a minute, I like this one more. Like, dude, the modus operandi stress montage, to me, is still the coolest thing ever edited.
Yeah.
Like, I watched that and I get so pumped to skate because I'm like, they almost, it's just like dramatic. That's that opened me to like, wait, like
the magic of Ty Evans.
Exactly.
Ty Evans. Yeah. Right.
So that when I saw that video, I was like, no way. Like there's a difference between this one and this one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Did you want to pick up a camera from that point? Cause sometimes it usually happens. You're in your skate crew.
Yeah.
Maybe the guy who's not as good as the rest of the guys picks up a camera. I'm kidding. Raj is a great skateboarder. No, you know what I mean,
though? Totally.
It's like, you know, that, but other people, they find, they just like Tim Dowling, I think he liked the way that he saw skating through camera.
So what happened with me was that being kind of green to everything, it was another situation of where I had no idea this existed. Mm-hmm. And my friend Troy came to me and said, hey, we're going to make our own video. Do you want to have a part? And I was like, what? We could do our own video? Like, that's insane. Like, it was such
an option.
It was such like an exciting time in life to like not know what's possible and to somebody just be like, boom, you know? Like, I miss those days. That's pretty cool.
Were you 16 or something?
It was that 6th, 7th grade kind of like time. It was probably like more closer to 8th grade. Mm-hmm. And I was like, no way. Like, we can make a video. And I became obsessed with that. Mm. And then we constantly filmed, but nobody was like really like putting it together and in charge of it. And so I felt like, I was like, dude, I'm going to make this happen.
Okay.
So I kind of like became the leader of that.
Who had the camera?
My buddy had the camera, but I was the guy that wanted to film every single trick, even if it wasn't good. My whole thing was like,
learn how to use it.
Yeah. I was like, I didn't know at the time that I can like make it look cooler. I just thought we filmed everything and I would film stuff that they would tell me like not to film, but then they'd be like, dude, that actually looks really cool.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm not saying I was a good filmer at all as a kid, but it was rad to like, I had that spark and that love.
Right. For it. But it seems to me like filming kind of took over from skateboarding.
I did want to be sponsored though.
Oh, you did?
Because I didn't know you could be a filmer. Like I had no idea that you could do that for a living.
Yeah.
I had no idea you can even make a dollar off of it. I was like, oh, I want to be a pro skater. Like, I was sending photos into Photo Graffiti and Thrasher. And I'm like, I was getting in those like pretty consistently. It was weird.
you were in Photo Graffiti?
Dude, like 4 or 5 times. Like, it was like easy back then. I don't know what it was.
Here's this Chris Ray dude again. Throw him in there, bro.
I was sending Sponsor Me videos to Chocolate nonstop.
No way.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Kenny probably said no.
Dude. But the best thing ever was I sent it to Stamina Clothing back then.
Oh, yeah.
And I got a letter back. And I think I still have the letter. But it said, hey, thanks for sending in the video, but our team is full at the time. And to me, that meant to me, like, dude, I'm good enough. But the team was full.
So, I was being polite.
Yeah. It was so rad. And like this dude at Chocolate would send me like a shirt.
Okay.
Just like each time I sent in a video, I would just like Dan Field, I think was his name. And I would just, he would write me like a really nice letter. And I mentioned it to Mike Carroll once and he was like, how do you know that dude? Like, how do you know that name? And I was like, dude, I used to send Sponsor Me videos. And he's like, that's crazy. And I'm like, yeah, he'd send me like extra small shirts and they wouldn't fit, but I'd still wear them.
No. Mm-hmm. Wow.
That's pretty nice of them, man.
Yeah, it was awesome. It was pretty cool.
So you never got sponsored, or did you? Skate shop?
Like skate shops and like local companies.
What were you doing? In these Sponsor Me videos, were you doing like good shit, or were you how good of a skateboarder were you back then?
Okay.
What's your best trick?
The best trick.
How high can you all?
Well, I mean, dude, I suck at skating now. I can't do anything.
Right.
But I did, like, do you guys remember In Modus, that rail in the hallway in Sacramento?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so, because we lived in Concord, so we'd go out there, and, like, I Smith grinded, lip slid that. And
those were in your Sponsor Me videos.
Yeah.
Oh, that's and
that,
great.
That was, like, I was more of a zero kid, even though I really like chocolate. That made no sense. I was obsessed with chocolate, but yet, when Misled Youth came out, I went, like, kind of zero style. But yeah, those are probably the best tricks I did, I guess.
It's funny when you say zero style.
No
style.
No, zero style. I never got swamped. I never went pro. I would get like free boards here and there and stuff like that. But
sounds like you had a pretty good scheme going on. You're just sending in these skate videos and getting free shit.
I mean, dude, it was more of, and I think I'm still, it's not like a, it's like a hustle in a sense, yeah, but it's like, I just reached out and I think that companies were like, yeah, we'll send them a board or two. And
well, you got to think though, back then, like how many people were hitting up these companies, right? Nowadays, it's like, it's probably like every fucking day.
Totally.
So,
and I was making videos for my friends and sending their Sponsor Me videos off and kind of acting that way, which I didn't even think about it at the time.
Manager style?
Yeah, I didn't think, it wasn't like that. It was just like, I was the person that's going to do that. Mm. Like, I'm going to make that happen.
Yeah, well, that's nice of you.
Yeah.
Imagine if they got sponsored.
They did. They got like boards and stuff. And, like, we'd go after like weird sponsors, like Randoms Hardware. We'd be like, hey, dude, I'm going to get you on Randoms. Like, do you remember that? Where you pound them in they're like skulls on top.
Skulls on top.
But like you can't loosen them. So like I would go after like the companies that I think we actually had a chance. Yeah, girl and chocolate wasn't happening. So,
But you still tried though. You still tried.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Stamina was a tight choice, though. Stamina was sick.
I know.
Yeah.
That was good.
Too bad the team was full, man.
Yeah.
Team was full.
God damn it.
I'll have to dig up that letter.
You know? That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's amazing. So you're in NorCal, right? You said you grew up with Corey Duffel.
Yeah. I would skate the Castle contest and enter those, and he'd show up and win them all. So
you were a Castle dude, too?
Yep.
Castle.
Yep.
Did you do well in any of them, or?
I don't think so.
Did you have to skate Castle?
No, I was never a contest dude. Like, no.
But dude, at that age, I didn't think of it as like a contest, dude. I was just like, all of our friends are going to the park for the weekend, and it happens to be a contest in a sense. Like, it was kind of like that.
Yeah,
I would get like, I would get like maybe like third place or something here and there. But it was never, I mean, dude, Corey Duffel was our local hometown dude, and he would just win.
Were you friends with him, or you you would just see him around?
It was one of those things where like he just got sponsored by Think. And it would be like, I'd see him at the concert, like, dude, Corey, like, I saw your ad. That's so sick. And he'd be like, yeah, cool kid. And then like skate off.
You're like the same age.
Yeah,
like,
exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
He's maybe younger.
Yeah. But it was like, he was in Walnut Creek and I was in Concord. And there was kind of like Concord versus Walnut Creek sense in a way. But I was the one in the group that was very like friendly with everybody.
Okay.
Yeah.
When did filming really take?
I'd say
take off for you.
I would say I took it really serious my freshman year in high school, and we still just continued to try to make our own videos.
Okay.
Editing was a nightmare because we didn't have like systems really. We
were, two VCRs.
Yeah, it would be like even just put all the footage on a VCR and then I'd play a song to it and we'd all watch it. You know, it was just, we had no idea what we were. It was like there was nobody around me to.
Yeah, but you're watching skate videos though.
Mm-hmm.
Like you had
I had no way of knowing how that was put together. I had nobody in our crew, nobody in, like, in our city.
Right.
I mean, the closest thing was that I figured out was like, oh, you can take it to in like an agency place or like a editing house and they could do it. But yeah. I mean, dude,
it's going to cost you money.
Yeah, we had no money. So.
Right.
At what point did you start like collecting skate spots for your book?
Dude, so that's interesting.
Because you had probably one of the best spot books ever.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's actually, like, that's what got me noticed by all the companies.
Yeah.
Was, you know, when I ended up...
Is this like a photo? Is this a photo album?
This is a photo album at the time.
Not Polaroid. Like, you would take a photo, get it developed, put it in your Walgreens book.
Yep.
Oh, at Walgreens.
Yeah.
And would you write, where would you write the directions, or how would you write the directions somewhere?
No, not at that time. Cause there's still no like pin drops or iPhones. It was just,
yeah, but I mean, like, you could write it on the back of the photo or something.
Thomas Guide.
Yeah. On the corner of 6th and Walnut.
Yeah. It was kind of like, I mean, when I did that, I was in Reno, which is a really small town. Oh. So it was very simple. But what kept happening was, like, eventually I went to my wife now, she went to college in Reno. I went out there on a skate trip and then I ended up moving out there. And then companies like started to come through town, like America would come to town and I'd be like, hey, I got spots. I'll show you guys around. Like, I'm the filmer. And they'd be like, oh, that's cool, kid. That's cool. And nobody like was biting at it. So I was like, I'm going to go take a photo of every single spot in town. And then that way, when they come to town, I'll bust open my laptop and I'll be like, look at all these spots. So Chocolate comes to town.
I was just about to ask you. Do we? I was probably...
You were there. You were there. So
you got my autograph that day, didn't you? Could you imagine?
I have your... No, you gave me your audio shoes.
Though. Oh,
you did.
No way.
Well, you didn't give me... You threw them in the back of my truck. And you didn't... They were just...
White Hamiltons, probably.
They were white leather. They probably didn't fit me, but I still probably skated in them and tried to wear them.
Look at that.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing. That's...
Yeah. So it was at the Gap you were trying to switch heel. I don't know if you remember that. I still have the footage of that, too.
I'm surprised I didn't do it.
Yeah.
Chris getting a Gap?
Yeah. What
the fuck is going on that day?
No. Yeah. Parking lot to parking lot.
Yep.
Dirt on the side of the road.
Yep.
Yeah. Dude, I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was there filming in the sun. I don't think I really talked to anybody, but...
I wonder. I didn't choose that spot. Yeah, somebody else must have chose that.
We went there the night before a tie, but I
was that the one that Mark Johnson switched frontside flip.
Yes, correct.
Okay,
that one.
Yeah. Justin Hart flipped it.
Yes, he did. Yep. That same day. Yeah.
So when Chocolate came to town, like, how did you hook up with them then?
Well, so I saw Kenny Anderson. I saw Kenny Anderson, and I was like, "Oh, hey, Kenny, I have all these spots. I want to show you around." He's like, "Oh, cool, man." And I was like, "Oh, here, I have this laptop." And he goes, "Whoa, you see that guy over there? That's Ty Evans. Go show him that."
Oh,
I was like,
really?
I was like, okay.
Where'd you see him at? Where was this?
Oh, this, like, is at the local skate shop at a autograph signing.
Okay. So you knew they were coming to town.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
You scoped it out. You were like, I'm bringing my laptop.
Favorite company.
They sent me a couple shirts.
This was way later on. Okay. But this is the point of, like, I'm not going to be a skateboarder.
Sure.
I mean, I was skating and
you
like
were already
parts
involved
in
though
video.
In this filming. You had a spot book for Christ's sake.
No, but it wasn't. I still at that point, I still didn't know you could be a filmer for a living.
Okay.
I still didn't know. Like, I just made a spot book because I was trying to figure out how can I grab their attention. So it was no, like, I just wanted to skate with the pros and film them.
Okay. And did you know who Ty Evans was?
I knew Ty from the videos, but I didn't, like, there were, like, with no social media back then, there was no
face to him.
Yeah, it was kind of just like, oh, that's Ty Evans. Like, okay, I've seen him in like the 4-on-1s and things like that. But I went up to him and I was like, hey, Ty, Kenny said to show you this. And I showed my spot book and I remember he kicked out his like a sidekick phone. Okay. And I was like, he's like, what's your number? And I was like, looking at the phone, like, what is that? Like, I'm in Reno and he's like, they're like months ahead. And I was like, dude, I'm so confused. And he's like, what's your number? And I'm like, so I give him my number. And even though I don't have a cell phone back then, this is before all that, you know?
Yeah.
And I go home that night and I think I'm in bed and the phone rings and he's like, hey, we're trying to find this hubba. Like, you want to meet us there? So I go and I meet him there and skate with him. And as soon as we get to the spot, I just take my broom out and I just start sweeping. And Tyler's just like, what the heck?
Okay. It's got a good workout there.
And then I brought a bench with me and I was like, because the hubba was pretty big. And I remember being like, here, you guys can warm up on this. And they were just like, oh, okay. You know, so then
I must have loved you, bro.
I didn't know.
Because that's his shit.
Yeah, like, I know. And I didn't know that he was like that.
Oh, you didn't know. You were just trying to go for it.
I was just trying to be as helpful as possible. Okay. So they let me stay on the session.
Yeah.
So we skated that night, didn't really get anything. And then he's like, hey, we're going to skate tomorrow. So we met up at this park. And then that's when I met you and you asked me for wax and you said, oh, so you're the lucky winner. And I was
I didn't.
Yeah, you did.
What do you mean? I'm
kind of like, you're the lucky one that gets to come out with us, you know? And I was like, yeah. I mean, I am. So the spot it was too was Richard Mulder did like crook fakie and the switch double flip flat ground.
Wait, crook fakie
and a switch double flip flat ground.
Oh,
there was, we put like a metal bench down the thing. Spike was there, so that was pretty crazy to see. Like,
what were you, did you have a VX?
I did, yeah.
Oh, so you were fully okay.
I was filming, but probably just like long. Like,
but by then you knew VX, you knew everything.
Yeah, but I didn't know like settings. I didn't know anything.
Oh, really?
Like, I didn't know. Again, there was nobody there to really be like, this is what you do. Okay. I mean, I had it on autofocus, auto white balance, everything. I just knew that this was the camera I saw in the magazines, and I saved up for it.
So you gave me wax. Did you have wax?
I gave you wax.
Yeah.
I had wax.
What was I waxing?
The bench was really bad material. It was like the metal that doesn't grind.
Okay.
And then we went to that gap.
I must have killed that ledge.
The footage never came out.
I know. What is?
We went to that gap, and then everybody just kind of headed off to Salt Lake and said goodbyes. And
this was Hot Chocolate tour.
Hot Chocolate, yeah. Mm. And I was so stoked that it worked. I was like, I can't believe it. I made the spot book. I got to skate with the pros. This is one of my favorite companies. I couldn't believe it. And I was like, I'm going to make a spot disc and I'm going to send it to every single company. So I sent it out to every single company.
For Reno.
And I said, hey, this is a photo of all my spots. And if you come out here, I'll show you guys around for free. I just want to learn from your filmer and I just want to film.
Oh, wow.
At this point, I don't know that you can charge day rates. I didn't know you can even get paid for footage in videos. Like, right. I was just like, dude, on the weekends, I might be able to film a pro. That's crazy.
That's kind of every kid's dream, right? Is to be surrounded by these guys you see in videos and all that shit too.
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it worked for the next year. I would say companies just kept like, they would just show up in Reno and they'd call me and they'd say, hey, we're here. You know, the flip team, you know, the Alien Workshop dudes, like, and Reynolds came. Reynolds like came up to me right away and he goes, hey man, are you the kid that like sent the spot book in? And I was like, yeah. And he goes, you're crazy.
Yeah, right.
He goes, that is amazing. Cause dude, nobody had done that.
Yeah.
Nobody had like had a spot book. There was no social media. Mm-hmm. There was no,
it was like an invite to your city in a way.
Sure.
Yeah. You couldn't like, just nobody was doing this.
Yeah. Right.
And literally like for 2 years, I met everybody through that.
Did Ty ever call you back?
Ty was super cool because he brought Beeble back on a trip and Beeble switched 360 the double set at the University of Reno.
Oh.
And I filmed it from the top and I think I had like a really good angle where it looked bigger.
Okay.
And then Ty filmed it fisheye. Beeble actually, I think, liked my angle better. My angle never got used because I filmed it all in auto. So like I didn't film it right, but Beeble didn't know that.
Oh.
But when Beeble watched the footage, he was like,
that's Ty.
He's like, you're the man. Here's my extra board. Come to Sacramento anytime. And he like immediately had my back, but he didn't know that like the footage looked bad but he just looked at the angle and was like, that's awesome.
So when these companies were coming into town, was your footage getting used? Would they grab your angles or would they?
Not really, because videos at that time still were taking like so many years. Okay. I mean, Ty put a couple clips, like even just the guys kind of like walking by and like
B-roll.
Yeah, he put some B-roll in the Hot Chocolate video.
Oh,
and
sick.
When my name was in the credits, like I thought I made it. I was like, did it. I was like, I've done it. Like the company that I looked up to the most and all the writers, and I was like, my name is in that video. Awesome.
Wow.
Still didn't know you can get paid. Still didn't know they owed me money.
You didn't. Yeah.
I had no idea. And then that wasn't until the America team came to town and I filmed their demo. And John Miner, I saw him after and I was like, hey, dude, I filmed some clips of the demo. Can I send you the footage? And he's like, sure. So I sent him the tape. And then he calls me one day, I'm at work. And he says, hey, this is John Miner. We need you to just sign off on this. We owe you money. And I was like, we owe me money for what? And he's like, for the footage. I was like, wait, you can get paid for filming skating? He goes, yeah, we owe you like $150, $175. And I was like, dude, is my name in the credits? And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, I'm pushing it a little bit farther. Can I get a copy of the video? He's like, yeah, I'll make you one right now. I was like, no way. I was like, dude, I'm actually making my own video. And if you want to have clips in it, send me a clip. And he was just like weirded out. He's like, dude, what are you talking about?
Just like, I'm calling you to pay you.
And he's just like, okay, dude, I'm going to pay you. And I'm like, wow, I got paid for skating. And that
was your first check.
First check ever. Yeah. Was from Soltech.
Damn. Where were you working at that time?
I was working at a warehouse that was like shipping out like AC parts.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, I was working there that's what I was doing. I was like literally like packing up parts to ship out, and I got that call and I was just like, dude, this
I'm quitting my job,
man. I know, right?
Not even that, it was more just like of a life hammer, because it was like I'm gonna always film because I love it.
Here's the thing though too, is like you put in the work though. You know what I mean? You made the spot books. You put yourself out there. You know, some filmers would have just been like, hey, I got some spots. Show them around. Sit in the corner. Wait for somebody to do, like, you got the broom out, like, you were doing it, bro.
Yeah, but I didn't, like, I was just amazing. I was just obsessed with skating. I was obsessed with, you know, pros and seeing it and seeing like really gnarly tricks go down. I was still making my local videos. And then that relationship from Beeble really, like, he, you know, Sacramento's only 2 hours away.
Okay.
So he would call me, like, Mark would go up there and they'd be like, hey dude, Mark Johnson's in town. We need a filmer, come up here. So I'd go up there and film those dudes.
Did your friend from Reno ever call you up for like blowing up the spots?
No, not at all. Because it was all like, the more that we had people come to town, it was
more shine for them.
Yeah, it was like they were hyped. They were hyped with me, and it was like, unfortunately, I didn't get to like take them with me on sessions.
I was about to say,
yeah, but
so
but,
you knew enough not to do that.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I knew that, but they were all hyped. They're like, dude, you're doing it. You're filming like the girl dudes.
Would you ever tell them, hey, we're gonna go to this spot that you could drive by and like?
No, I'd show them all the footage for sure. Okay. Yeah, and I know, like, even I felt like at that time it was like, if Ty knew I showed this clip, you know, to this I was like in trouble. But I was
in the camera you were showing him, because
I was having to come to my house, dude.
Yeah, I mean, you could fuck the tape up.
I didn't know that back then. Yeah, okay. I was filming an LP. I still didn't know my settings at this point.
You're filming LP.
Wait until you hear when I learned my settings. So that will come up later. It's crazy.
How much later are we talking?
I mean, when I got hired by Lakai, I went on my first Lakai trip, and it was with like Costin, Rick, Mike, Ty, Cairo, Linosi, everybody. And that was like the first time that I learned all that stuff.
It's interesting that Ty wouldn't like show you, or then, maybe you didn't want to ask.
No,
you,
I
you
just wasn't, I wasn't,
you weren't all in yet.
I wasn't seeing him enough. It would be like,
well, just on that one trip, you could have gone up to him and been like, hey,
on the Lakai trip?
No, on the hot chocolate tour.
Oh, that was a day. That was just one day.
I know, but still.
Yeah, I mean.
Well, how did that happen? Did you ask him, or is he like, hey, let me show you how this works?
When we were on the trip, he's like, hey, this is how you set focus. This is how you set white balance. This is like how you do it.
Well, because also too, when he's filming the Kai video, he has his settings that he wants to use for the video.
Yeah.
So he wants every filmer.
He knew I was down and I had the passion and dedication, but I just had nobody to show me the settings. And I think he saw that I was open to, I wanted to know,
right?
You know, I wasn't like this, like, oh, I know how to do this or that. I was like, I wanted to learn.
And that's what, I mean, Ty like loves teaching people, you know, he's that dude.
Do that Woodward every year.
He'll tell you anything he knows, you know? How did you go from showing people around in Reno to skating for, I mean, filming for Lakai?
So the plan eventually was that I met all these skaters and I saw that they were kind of all coming from LA. Mm. And really, Beeble was the only one in like NorCal that I kind of knew of.
Mm.
So I was like, okay, I need to move to LA. So I remember they came up and did like a Panasonic commercial with Beeble. It was kind of like a weekend with Beeble. Yeah. So Ty hit me. It was like, hey, come out and film. Help us or whatever. So I'm actually like in that commercial with those guys, like filming with a little handy cam. And
on auto.
Yeah, on auto. He probably set it up for me. So I was telling Beeble, I was like, hey dude, I'm gonna like try to like move to LA and become a filmer, you know, at this point. And he was like, no dude, you should move to SAC. Like,
of course.
Yeah. But before that, even like a really interesting story is that I had called Ty and I said, hey man, I want to be a filmer. And he goes, well, if you want to be a filmer, then you'll be in LA this weekend filming people. And I was working at a warehouse job in Reno. And I was like, okay, I'll go this weekend.
How far is Reno from LA?
Four or five hours?
More than that.
Longer than that. Yeah.
It's like seven.
Seven?
I want to say maybe like nine or something.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
It was pretty far. But this is what happened. So he said that and I was like, okay, I'll do it. I'll go to LA this weekend and I'll film, you know?
Okay.
And my car broke down that day.
Oh.
And I was like, okay, I can't call this dude until my car broke down. He's going to think that I'm lying.
You're lying, right.
And then so my boss is like, take my truck.
Seriously?
Yeah, he's like, take my truck, just fill it back up with gas. But the only issue is his truck is a Ford F-350 diesel extended bed, fully lifted, like hunting truck. Like,
did you ask him for a raise to be able to go?
Dude, I was like so thankful he let me take it, but I showed up showing I looked like an asshole. You know what I mean? Like, dude, to show up here. And like, so I hit up Ty and he's like, oh, I'm editing this 4-star Japan video, but I'm gonna hook you up with Scuba. So he meets me at the school. I meet up with Scuba.
This truck.
Dude, this truck is huge. Huge. And I show up and I'm coming out here thinking like, dude, I'm going to be so invited. Everybody's going to love me. I'm going to be filmed with the pros. Oh, I don't even have a plan where I'm going to stay. And dude, I show up and it's like harsh reality of like, we don't know you, like, but you can be on the session, but that's it, you know? Yeah.
So Do you think it was because of the truck or just because
the truck didn't help? I mean, the truck didn't help, and then like I'm just some random dude. So,
but you have Ty's blessing though.
Ty brings me here, but I still think it was like this awkward like, hey, this is great. And I mean, so it's Mike.
But it's also Scuba too. Scuba's filming also. I mean,
it was weird. Like, hey, sorry guys, but here's a dude I'm bringing here. Ty wasn't there. Ty dropped. Basically, came by and was like, hey, dudes, this is Chris. I got to go edit. See you later. Oh. And Mikey was there. Mikey Taylor, Tori Pudwell. I think Justin like Schulte.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was kind of like that kind of crew.
Gotcha.
And I meet them at like the Skittles Ledges, I think they were called. Yep. And I just kind of like, oh, Antoine Dixon was there too. So that was sick. He was like the nicest dude ever. Yeah. No tattoos whatsoever. Right. It's like, it was
clean
insane.
Slate.
Wow. Yeah. It was insane. Like he was the one that was actually like, hey dude, like, how are you doing? Where are you from? Like, and everybody else was kind of like, okay. So Scuba was super cool and he's like, hey dude, like we're gonna go skate tomorrow.
Okay.
We'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay. So I drive this truck around town, like, where do I park this thing? I park it on like Hollywood Boulevard out of all the places and just sleep in it. Dude, so I stay the night in it, and it's middle of summer too. So nobody's skating the next day until like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. And dude, this is when it gets crazy. They call me and I go out and meet him at this bank to ledge or bank to bench.
Okay.
The one that Guy Marion was like 180 fake 5-0 laser heels, like right when Guy first came back.
Yeah.
So we go there and Tori skating and Mikey skating, Atiba's there, Scuba's there, and I'm like, this is sick. The session just starts. Okay. Tori's trying to do a kickflip nose grind on the bench, not coming close at all. And I'm like, dude, I'm really thirsty. I'm going to go take a drink of water. I'm going to take a drink of water. And I look up and he does kickflip nose grind, 180 out.
Oh.
Perfect.
Oh, so were you filming? You were.
No.
Wait, but were you filming him
drinking water? Yes.
Oh, you were filming him, said, I need to go get a drink of water.
I didn't say anything. I figured the session just started and he's not even coming close. I just wasn't thinking.
Yeah.
And everybody gets together and they're like, that was insane. Oh, hey, can we watch your angle? And I go, I missed it. And they all go, Pook. And I was like, this really sucks. Like, I'm not as well, like, I expected to have this whole like, dude, right, welcome, like, you know, I don't know what I expected for to land a job. I expected to be so welcome. I expected to be like best friends with these dudes, and I didn't know, you know. Right. And I called Ty and I was like, hey dude, I'm going home. I was just like super bummed, and he's just like, okay. So I went home and I was having a really bad week at work. And I went to go like ship out a package and I shipped like the wrong label on it or whatever. And I was telling like, I was like, oh, we got to fix this. We got to fix this. And the dude that was the other manager, the big boss wasn't there. And he was like, oh, don't worry about it. Just let it go. And we kind of got into it and I left and I'm just like, dude, I can't work with this dude. I was just so pissed. So the next day we come back and we have this meeting and I'm like, I've cooled down.
Okay.
I'm like, I had a bad day. It was a bad moment, whatever. But like, we'll
get that 9-hour drive would have cooled you down. Well,
this is like that week. This is like that week. It's a bad week.
It's a bad week.
And I don't realize why it's bad. So we go into this meeting and it's basically like apologize to each other. Like, hey, my boss, like, you guys got to work with each other, work this out. And the dude goes, Chris is just pissed because filming isn't working out for him.
Oh.
And then, dude, I like literally almost cried right there. Because
it struck you.
He was right. And I had no idea. I had no idea that that's why I was upset and taking it out on everybody else.
Was he the dude that let you borrow his truck?
No. That was the big boss was there kind of like delegating the situation. Okay. It was just like, look, dudes, I want to go hunting all the time. I need you guys both to work here and do all this work because I want to go do my thing. And I was like, dude, you're right. I quit. I'm going to California. I'm going to be a filmer.
Wow.
My boss goes, whoa, can you give me 3 months? And I was like, I'll give you 3 months. But it hit me so hard that I was like, dude, if I don't go to California and
it's never gonna happen, this,
I'll regret it the rest of my life.
Meanwhile, your girl's in college though.
She's in college. She's just about to finish. Okay. And then, so basically,
was this a part of her plan too, to go to California? Or you
she
were,
didn't want to. She was just like,
well, it's like, hey, you dragged me to Reno. I'm dragging you to California.
Yeah. And she well, you know what? I take that back. She, I kind of assumed she didn't want to.
Oh.
And when I kind of talked to her about what happened and I was like, look, I really have to do this. And she's like, yeah, that's fine. And I was like, well, you're actually down. And she's like, yeah, let's go and give it a year and see what happens. And I was
what
like,
is she studying for? Because she can get a job. And
she's doing like criminal justice and stuff at that time, but she didn't. go to work for that.
Okay.
And then, so we ended up
high school sweethearts.
Fresh out of high school.
Okay.
Yeah. We knew each other in high school, but then right out of high school started dating.
And married now.
Married with kid. 13 years. Yeah. And with one kid and another one on the way.
Hey, congratulations. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Congratulations, so, yeah. man. You no should more. Name him after me, Chris.
Or after yourself.
And it's, oh, a, yeah, oh, and it's yeah. a girl. It's a girl.
Well, that's cool. K. K. R. I. S.
That's true.
Yeah. So you drag your girl to California. You move mm-hmm. 3 months. You quit your job.
Yes.
Obviously save up a little dough.
Yeah.
How do you know where you're going to move to? Are you just winging it?
So all I knew was Macy's Ledges in Sacramento. Mm-hmm. So ooh,
are really fucking good ledges.
Yeah,
those
so
are
the best ledges. I like just moved again. Like, dude, their internet wasn't like
popping.
It is now. Yeah, it's so easy to get to find a place.
Sure.
And I was still so young, I didn't really know what to do. But I just knew Macy's Ledges was in this zone. So I moved like right around the corner from there. That's how I picked where I was going to live.
Oh, so you're not even moving to like Southern California. Right,
no, I'm moving to Northern
California.
I'm moving to Sacramento because Beeble says, hey, dude, don't go to LA. Lakai said that they'll hire a filmer. Right. If I find one, they'll hire one.
Okay.
And the day that I moved to Sacramento, I got a check from Lakai.
Seriously?
Sure. Yeah.
What do you mean? You haven't even filmed anything yet?
No, but somehow a check showed up. Ty hooked it up.
Really? Yeah.
I mean, I wasn't making much money, but it was mind-blowing to me to get a check from a skate company that was, you know.
Just a retainer?
Yeah, I was on a retainer.
But at this time, too, you don't even know the caliber of this video.
Oh,
no one knew until that countdown.
You know what I mean?
No, like, dude, people. Like,
I would say being a fan of all those guys growing up, I was, and then even getting hired by them was crazy because I was probably more excited for that video than any other person in the world. Like any other person. Like not even saying because I worked for them.
Yeah, yeah.
It was like, dude, I can't wait to see this video more than anybody.
Right.
So to get hired by them, I was like, this is mind blowing.
And now is your girl tripping? Like, dude, you're now this is, no, you're I doing mean, it. I'm I mean, not, this I'm is like no making, tripping in a good way. Yeah, though. Like, yeah. like, wow, you brought me here. Now a check showing up in the mail. Like,
I mean, we're stressing because we're struggling for money, but it didn't really matter at that time. We didn't have like as many
well,
you're
bills.
Young. Yeah. We're still young.
You know,
But she was stoked. She was like, oh, cool. Like, she found a job real quick. And then I was working from like 6 a.m. until noon every day. And then I'd go and pick up the skaters and we'd film until 2 in the morning. And I'd go back to work at 6 a.m.
Damn.
Know? Yeah.
Were we working?
I was working just at a warehouse, just pulling parts. And
that was in Sacramento?
That was in Sacramento, yeah. Okay. Just as like a little thing where I was like, I have to have weekends off and I can do 6 to noon because skaters don't wake up before then.
Yeah. true but story.
Then, yeah, it got crazy while we were filming the Fully Flared because so many dudes would like film till really late and then I'd have to like go to work.
Well, plus trips too, right?
Well, I was only invited on one trip.
Oh.
Yeah, and that was the month-long tour that like Ty taught me how to film.
Okay.
And, yeah.
You got a check from Lakai.
Yeah.
Did not a film.
You don't
did
even know your film. Settings yet. Don't you don't even know.
No. Nope. And then I do a month-long tour and Ty, I'm rooming with
How
Ty.
Long after you got hired did you do that? Did you go on the
I'd
tour?
I'd say it was about 2 months.
2 months.
Yeah, and I mean, Ty is kind of like, teach me like a little bit of settings here and there. And
you're Beeble's personal filmer.
Beeble's personal filmer.
Right.
Trying to get more of the team to come up, but I don't really meet everybody else until the trip.
Okay.
And then after that trip, everybody just kept coming up. Like,
you had Welsh up that area too, right?
Yeah.
Oh, that's true.
Bunch.
That's
yeah.
true.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's yeah. a bunch of, I mean,
I'm sure you got some good stories there.
There's some funny ones. Like, and Welsh and I didn't really get along while working on the video, but looking back at it now, I was super young. And he was dealing with a video that was super stressful.
Sure.
The impact of it, I had no idea, you know? And even like at one point, like I was like, oh, hey, when you film Welsh, tell him he's not going to have a full part. And I was like, okay. Like, Alex, yeah. Yeah. Right. And like, and then looking back,
who was telling you to tell him this?
I'm not going to say a name, okay. but it was like I delivered that news, but being that young, I didn't know that that was like the bad news.
Oh, they literally said, like, by the way, it wasn't even joking. Like, by the way, tell me he's not going to have a full
part. Yeah, I was like the messenger, and I was like, oh, hey, dude, by the way, like, how you doing, man? Oh, hey, you're not going to have a full part. Like, you know what I mean? And I'm just like, looking back.
Were they
I'm
telling
like,
you that to fire him up, or like?
I think that because Rob and I were like, we would kind of like argue on trips, but he would kind of like pick on me and stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking shit on Rob at all. Like, looking back at it, I totally understand the situation that he was in. I totally understand why he felt the way he did towards me because
he's a difficult person to film with. Because like, I went on a trip with him for aesthetics, or whatever. And he goes, I don't even know why you're here. We're not gonna film shit.
Yeah,
that's he positive.
Was straight
I mean,
up, like,
I mean, dude,
down.
When I first met him, I was like, hey, dude, it's nice to meet you. And he goes, we'll never be friends. And I was like, what? And I was like, why? And I was like, why? And he goes, because you're a filmer and I'm a skater. And I was like, that's okay. Weird. But like, again, looking back, I totally looking back, like, again, like no harsh feelings towards him.
Yeah. You gotta love a guy like that, though. It's like funny. Yeah.
It was a great experience, but it was at the time I took it so hard because I thought that I'm filming for this company. I'm a part of the crew.
Sure.
Everybody loves each other. And I've never had issues like filming my friends growing up that we didn't like each other.
Right.
So it was the first time I had experienced like a coworker that didn't get along with. And I was like, wait, people don't get along in skateboarding.
He's like, this is just a business relationship.
Yeah. And I totally understood it. And we even had one situation that was hilarious, and I have to tell this. And this, again, this is not talking shit on Welsh at all. This is one of the funniest things that ever happened looking back on it. So I just moved to Sacramento. I live right by Mesa's Ledges. And he's coming from San Francisco to film at Mesa's Ledges.
Okay.
And Matt Miller's also driving up because they're good homies. So he's driving up separately. Again, no iPhones, things like that. I tell him, hey, dude, you have to get off on Watt Avenue. That's the only way I know how to get there. This is like, I can't tell you any other way. Don't get off anyway. So he calls me back and he says, hey, dude, I got off by the Honda dealership. And I was like, dude, I don't know where that is. I told you to get off on Watt. And he's like, there's a lot of traffic. Like, I don't tell me how to get there. And I'm like, dude, I don't know. But Matt Miller's trying to call me also. I got to tell him what exit to take. So I go to click over and I go, oh, sorry, dude. Welsh is being an idiot. And he goes, it's still me.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. I'm like, dude. And I like looked over my wife and I'm just like, oh, my gosh. Like, I just got fired. He's like, why are you talking shit behind my back? Like, I'm going to punch you in the face when I see you. And I'm like, I'm not talking shit behind your back. I said it to you. Like, just trying to get myself out of it. Right. And then we meet up at Mesa's Ledges and he's walking across the parking lot. I'm walking across the parking lot. And I just tighten my job. Ready like to get he was going to punch.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then he's just like, why are you talking shit? And I was like, dude, we got to just film this video, man. Like, Ty wants you to film this video. I want to film this video. Like, let's just film the video. And that's it. And again, not trying to talk bad about the dude
for sure.
It was a stressful time for like all those dudes.
Oh yeah.
And I was so young. I didn't know that the stress level. I was more excited than anything. And I had no stress. You know what I mean? Until I went off to go do my own videos. And that's when I was like, oh, I see what everybody's going through.
Yeah.
So I feel bad. So I apologize to Rob for,
Did you ever talk to him afterwards?
No, it
seriously was a business relationship. Yeah.
As soon as the video ended, we didn't.
That was it.
Yeah, that was it. But
I love Rob.
You guys gotta get him on the show, dude.
I know
he'd be great.
Fucking
on the show.
Great dude.
Yeah,
he can bust people's balls pretty good.
But that's the thing, though. It's like somebody listening would be like, "Dude, Welsh is a dick." But like us knowing him is like, that's fucking hilarious. Yeah. Like that's so Welsh. Yeah. You know.
Yeah. And dude, the little Kai dudes, like Mike and I would say it was more Mike. Like they were entertained by it. So they were like egging it on and like putting us in situations. So again, like looking back now, dude, okay, like there was a lot of things that happened that. He was being a dick because it was kind of like forced into it. They were being entertained by it.
Yeah.
So they're pressuring it for sure.
So the video took a long time.
But I think I was there for like the last 2 years or a year and a half.
Still a long time though. Two years, still a long time.
Yep.
You complete the video, right? What do you do now for a job? Well, no, huge video though, by the way. Great work. The premiere was insane.
The countdown clock.
The
clock was...
I could imagine that you were feeling the stress as well. No,
I was so excited.
You weren't stressed
so
at all.
So excited.
Well, he wasn't editing.
Yeah, he was at
that wasn't editing.
I know, but still, it's like crunch time. You gotta go out with guys, get some...
I was the NorCal filmer. So what was happening was like... I would drop off somebody at the airport and then like pick somebody up. Mm. And I was just like, dude, I could film another pro this weekend. Right, like Linosi's with me. This dude's with me. Like I was
wet behind the ears, totally. So to speak.
Totally.
Yeah. Okay.
Totally. So that video was wrapping up and Carol basically said, hey, we're gonna make a chocolate video, which ended up being pretty sweet. But originally it was going to be a chocolate video. And he goes, you know, do you want to film for chocolate? And I was like, absolutely. So
Kenny didn't have enough footage.
Yeah.
I had a full part, bro.
He gave it. They did the audio free DVD thing. He gave it away.
It's really hard for Kenny to get tricks, man. No, let me tell you.
But when he does, it's beautiful, man.
It is beautiful. Yeah. So
I'm
he
totally kidding, by the way. Yeah. Totally kidding.
So he, they had that plan, and I was like, you know what? I really don't want to work at the warehouse anymore. Mm-hmm. I want to film full time. And then Jason Hernandez had been coming up to Sacramento a lot to film Stefan because he was filming for Transworld and Habitat. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know what? What if I film for chocolate, but then everything that isn't chocolate, I just give to Transworld. Mm. And then those two small paychecks kind of make it to where I don't have to work that warehouse job.
Okay.
So so I have the Carol's got me locked into the chocolate thing. You know, we're talking about that, so I'm counting on that. And then Jason comes up and he's at Stefan's house, and basically I'm talking to him. I'm like, hey, dude, like I have this idea I want to talk to you about. I'm going to film chocolate, but everything non-chocolate, I'm going to give to you guys. Like, what do you think?
Yeah.
And he goes, oh, dude, I quit. This is like my last video. And I was just like, dude, this is the worst news ever. Because that was my whole plan, you know? And I was like, damn, dude, like, well, who's the new Transworld swimmer? And he's like, you are. Whoa. And I was like, what? And he goes, yeah, they asked me who we should hire, and it should be you. And I was like, what?
Why would he say this? Not to say that you were not a good filmer, but you literally just learned how to film.
Well, at this point it took off, because it was like the first Lakai trip to basically that point, I was filming stuff on Omar, people, and everybody coming up.
Yeah, all the sacrifices.
So I learned a lot in that time because of our deadline.
2 years.
Correct. Maybe. Yeah.
Right.
So at this point I knew how to film. I still didn't know necessarily like how to put together a full video and like
how to edit properly.
Yeah, exactly.
But that's a part of the Transworld videos,
totally,
no?
Yeah, exactly. So when he told me that news, I was just blown away, because growing up, Girl Chocolate was my favorite company. Mm-hmm. And yet my first job is with Lakai with all those dudes. And then my second favorite dream job is Transworld video, which I'm like, those are the two ones that I'd want. And Stefan was like, oh yeah, I was just skating with Kyle Leeper. And he said that, because Kyle Leeper is good friends with John Holland. And he's like, yeah, he said that the new Transworld filmer is Chris Ray. I was just like, dude, this is insane, because I just found out that
they already picked you.
Yeah, like all these people knew, but I had no idea that Jason even quit until 2 seconds ago, and yet I have the dream job. So I was like, hey, dude, what should I do? And he's like, just call John. Just call him. I never even talked to the dude. Call John. And I was like, hey, this is Chris Ray. And he's like, yeah, Jason says you're the dude. You're awesome. Like, you interested in doing it? We're going to pay you full time. And I was like, absolutely.
Yeah, but now you have to quit. Pretty sweet, no?
No, because it didn't even start. Oh. So it was actually like right before Fully Flared even wrapped up.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So even for like a hot set, it was like maybe like 2 months I was getting paid by both.
Oh, so now you slide right into a new job.
Slide right into the dream job.
That's really...
Yeah. Dream job to dream job.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Wow. And John Holland, dude.
John Holland taught me a lot of stuff.
Great dude.
Yep.
Easiest dude to work with. A great... Why are you laughing, Raj?
He hated working with you.
He hated working with me. I loved working with him.
Well,
I was hurt most of the time. Yeah. I was trying. He would call me every day. Are you better?
I'd be like, yeah, no, John, I'm not. Torn Achilles, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Horrible.
I would love to have him on the show, or we should have him on the show and have him talk about.
I just saw him at the last Transworld Awards.
Oh, yeah.
I haven't seen him in a long time.
Yeah, you should great have John guy. On. You should have John on.
Go ahead, though. About to say.
Well, working with John was. You know how Ty is.
Yeah.
Ty's like a grinder.
Hyper focused.
He's just like, dude, going for it 100%.
At 100 miles an hour.
Yeah. And like not taking no for an answer.
Mm-hmm.
And then I go to John and I kind of like try to have that grinder 100%. Like, this is what we're doing. Like, no, like everybody's skating kind of like attitude.
Mm-hmm.
And John was like, whoa, dude, like you got to chill out. So it was like, I thought that the Ty's way was the only way. So working with John, it like really bounced out. I like kind of like landed in the middle.
Well, because here you are, first job, and you're on the Ty program.
Yes.
So you think that that's kind of the standard.
And Ty's program was really similar to my boss's program at the warehouse.
Oh, so you
so in real life, like you weren't allowed to like take breaks. If you were like off the forklift. So to go from this to Ty, I was like, this is awesome.
Yeah.
But then to go with John, he like had to sit me down and be like, hey, dude. You got to
settle down.
Yeah.
And you guys are splitting dudes too, right? Yeah. What video was this?
That was, And Now was our first one.
Okay.
So, I had Matt Miller, David Gravett, and Sean Malto.
There's a great Sean Malto story that he told about David Gravett.
Yeah. Yeah. That was awesome. That was,
Sean Malto was there at this one place that David was trying to skate a rail. Mm-hmm. David got broke off. And David Gravett would never skate in front of Malto ever again.
Yeah, there was like, I think it was more of a competition thing, but he definitely got hurt. And then it got to the point where it was just like, well, Malto's bad luck.
Yeah, that's what it was.
So yeah, it was definitely.
So you knew that, you know the story.
Oh, I knew all about it. Okay. And I told Malto after the video.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah.
He didn't realize
it during the video. Yeah. And then looking back, he was like, oh, okay. Like, that makes sense.
That's why you guys always
And that's actually off. Too, like, even their parts are first and last.
Yeah.
We separated those guys.
Oh, you?
I didn't even realize that.
I gotta talk to Gravette about this. I have to.
They were both like rail chompers at the time too. So I probably felt that competition.
There was competition.
That's true.
There was competition for sure. It was funny because they're so opposite. We got creature and you got girl. Yeah, and it was just so opposite.
So Trans World. Mm-hmm. Fuck, man.
It was amazing. It
took about, 9 months, mm-hmm. 10 months to film?
Yeah.
Usually that's about standard Trans World video, which is hard. It's hard to bust out a video mm-hmm. in less than a year.
Yeah, it's really tough.
Well, you guys are traveling a lot for those videos, right?
That was the first time I went out of the country, and the very first trip I ever did, I went all over Australia, and then we went straight from Australia to China, like Shenzhen and stuff. I had never been out of the country, so to go to the one of the best places ever and to go to a complete culture shock. That was insane.
Do you guys have issues like going to China with your camera gear?
No, not back then. Cause it was all VXs. Right? Mm. Yeah. Then in Shenzhen, it was so early on that if you were skating a spot and people were walking by, they stopped.
Yeah.
And they would be there for hours.
They've never seen it before.
No, they didn't even see a white person. So they were tripping when we were there.
What's the issue with bringing cameras there?
Oh, when I went there, they confiscated two of my HVXs.
Confiscated. Oh, yeah. What did you do?
I luckily had a DSLR set up in my backpack.
But you have to have you have to have that. So now when we travel, you have to fill out a list of every camera equipment you bring in with serial number. Yeah.
So you're not selling.
You're not selling it. So usually when we go through there, it'll be we'll pick out one thing. They'll be like, show me this item. And then you have to, here it is. Yeah, and then they're like, okay, go ahead. And actually with your situation that happened, that's made me aware of it because of when I was just like, what do we have to do so I don't get what Roger did?
They had mine the entire time I was there.
And so when you went back to the airport, you picked it up?
Getting it back was the biggest nightmare ever.
I bet.
Because they told me, I flew out of Guangzhou to...
Guangzhou? What trip was this?
It's an enjoy trip.
Oh. Yeah.
I had my layover in a different city, whatever. Hong That's Kong. Where I took my... Guangzhou to Shenzhen, I think, maybe.
That's a weird one. It's pretty close.
And, they told me I basically had to go to customs and get my gear. Mm-hmm. So when I got the plane, whenever I went straight to customs thing, they're like, oh, you need to leave the airport to go to customs.
Yeah. Oh, God.
It's a nightmare.
I basically ended up missing my flight.
Jeez.
Had to I was there for another day, pretty much.
Jesus.
But when you were on these trips, though, you were filming everyone on the trip, or you still were just on those?
Yeah, we were filming everybody. But usually, when you have your assigned dudes, you were kind of lining up smaller trips. Mm-hmm. I would do an Atlanta trip or something. Mm-hmm. And then John was like, oh, we're going to Arizona this weekend, and just smaller crew. So mm-hmm. that way they get their complete focus. But those were those dudes. And then those are the parts that you kind of edited to. Well, so you really split it up.
Sorry, Chris.
Go ahead.
When you went on small trips with mm-hmm. Malto and Gravette, how did that even work?
So we didn't actually, I would split those up. Yeah, and Gravette stayed at my house for a long time during that video, so he would stay at my house and Taylor Bingaman's. And then when I did the Atlanta trip, it was actually just Miller and Malto, because we went out there to specifically get that line that he does the nose blunt down the first hill and then back nose blunt down the next one. So we went there for that. So
the back nose blunt on Cyclops rail?
It's like two rails in a row.
That was what was last tricks was in the back over crook on the Cyclops
Malto's trick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That wasn't planned, but that just happened on that trip.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So we went out there specifically for that.
Wow. That's the one with the rock hubba with the.
The one Jamie Thomas back lit.
Corey broke his arm.
He's talking about it.
Yeah. I filmed that. That was crazy.
Oh, you filmed that?
Yeah. I probably went to the hospital with that dude five times while working on his part.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Dude. Yeah.
How is it filming with Corey?
It's awesome.
Yeah.
Especially like whole growing up with him.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
This is crazy. Because he was always the hometown hero and I admired him. So I was like, when I got a job at Transworld, he's like, hey, give me a part. And I was like, dude, we have to do a Corey Duffel part.
Hey, did you get a lot of that though? Like people were like, hey, let me get a part.
Loved it.
Listen, Transworld videos were the videos. Mm-hmm. It shows a company that you're mm-hmm. fucking working hard. You're not just doing a company video.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of dudes turn pro after these videos.
I loved it.
It's huge.
I loved it. It was... If somebody asked to do a part, it made us want to do it more. If I asked somebody to do a part and they said, let me think about it, I'd be like, hey, you know what, dude? Actually, we're not interested, because if you have to
you
do this
be all
in 8 months,
right?
If you don't fully commit, then we can't. This isn't going to work.
You're
the same with booking a guest here.
I would imagine. I mean, when people ask you, do you guys get more stoked?
Yeah.
Of course. Right? You don't want to go chasing after people. Yeah. You know, it's like either you want to do it or you don't.
Like if someone wants to come on, fuck yeah, sit down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But if we're like, trying to like force someone to sit there.
But it's also a weird thing though, Raj, too, asking people and them asking us. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like sometimes that could be a weird thing.
I learned, you know, I learned over the time of doing the transfer parts is that you're with this person. They become like your new spouse for 8 months and like, you have to make sure that you're going to get along.
Yeah.
So, so as I started to figure it out and learn that not everybody gets along in skateboarding, true, this is really a shock to me. I would almost be like, hey, come to my house for like the week and like, let's test this out,
right.
Yeah. And then like, dudes would come stay and
I'd be
like,
a little bit.
Yeah. And I'd be like, I'd be like, oh yeah, this dude can't do it.
It's can't do it. Cause you're literally going to be calling him every day.
Every day.
Yeah.
Yep. It's really weird to go from one video to the next where your phone is like the favorite recent history. And then all of a sudden, like you don't talk to those people.
Don't talk. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Wow. But that's how it goes though.
That's how it is.
You know?
Yeah. Project to project.
Yeah. Project to project, man. Mm-hmm. That community asked me to do a transworld video.
You already had a part.
So?
I was a NorCal dude.
I would have loved to work with you, bro.
I picked
bro.
NorCal dudes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I was NorCal. I always like kind of picked people because I was still in Sacramento at this point.
Yeah. Oh,
so I would pick people that were like the Bay Area kind of like
easy.
Yeah. gave Transworld kind of like something different because mm-hmm. when Jason and John were down here, they were doing so LA, many guys in this area. Yeah. Yep. So like I was kind of like, hey, this is actually perfect because I'm up here. We can get some like NorCal love absolutely. In the video. So it worked out. Eventually I just ran out of NorCal dudes and I had to move down here.
Did you feel pressure?
Yes, I was really stressed. I was probably not super easy to work with or like super fun necessarily.
Why?
Because I just didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know like, I mean, I was putting the pressure on the dudes, like especially like Malto, because I knew how big of a skater he was going to be and how big of a deal this part was going to be.
Right.
And I think I weirded him out on like pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And I would stress. I had no idea what I was doing.
You're trying to get your job done too, though.
Yeah.
It's a dream come true. And it's like, I don't want to let everybody down. And I'm sitting there thinking like, dude, at the premiere, what if the video goes out? What's going to happen? I would stay up like late at night, just wondering like what happens if it doesn't play. And it did.
Now you're driving yourself crazy.
Totally.
Yeah.
Totally. But I had never experienced any of it. So I was expecting the worst and didn't know what to do. For
sure. But what about editing though?
So
is John going to take care of all the editing?
So, editing,
because you didn't know how to do any of the editing yet, right?
I edited a lot of my local videos.
Okay.
But I would like edit the videos and John would be like, look, this is what's wrong with this.
Mm.
And I would stay at, I just lived at Transworld office for an entire month before the premiere. So I would just edit.
Sleep on the couch.
Yeah. Just sleep right there and like, tell me what I need to do.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And John taught me a lot with editing.
Final cut. At that point?
That was Final Cut. Final Cut, yeah. Yep.
Here's a question. We always talk about this. Mm-hmm. I'm always interested. Raj hates filmer. He hates the word filmer.
Yeah,
he likes camera operator. Mm-hmm. You know, what about cinematographer, Raj? Cinematographer?
Like cinematographer, no.
You don't like cinematographer either.
Cinema is film. I'm not shooting film.
I'm
recording to our fucking card.
I love that though. He's so precise in what he wants to in what he's doing.
For a long time.
But filmer is the, it's what everybody says though, you know?
When I was just a skate filmer, I would be like, I'm a filmer. Okay. Like, that's what I would say. I mean, nowadays people are like, oh, what do you do? And I go, I'm a filmmaker. Because it's like, sometimes I'm directing, sometimes I'm producing, sometimes I'm just camera operating.
Yeah.
I mean, I know I'm not always shooting on film, mm-hmm. but it's like,
I think it just kind of, it's one of those words that mm-hmm. just,
but if you break out the bollocks, you're filming.
I do.
But it lives on, though. Yeah. No matter if it's film or digital, it's a filmmaker. Yeah. You're not a digital maker. You know, it's just like the word just kind of lives.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
Content maker.
But everybody's got their thing, though, right? Like, that's Raj's, like, he doesn't like filmer. He likes cinematographer. Mm-hmm. Camera operator.
Yeah.
You know, he's operating a camera, you know? You don't care. Oh, filmmaker.
I like filmmaker. I mean, because I do a lot of stuff outside of skateboarding too. And I think that
you actually just did a film, right?
I did. I shot my first like narrative short film piece, actually. It was, it's one of the scariest things I've ever had to do because I've never done that.
You edit or just?
I didn't do the edit, but it was, it's basically shot in an RV with Ann Cusack, who's John Cusack's sister. She was in like a League of Their Own back in the day. Yeah. And she's been on like the movie Soli and stuff.
Mm.
And it's about human sex trafficking. And they basically were like, all right, you're going to be on gimbal in this RV that's in a studio. And they're like rocking it back and forth. They have like reflectors going. So it looks like cars are passing.
You're rocking it, but you're on a gimbal.
Like everything is shaking in the gimbal, but like, you're in this spot that's only like 2.5 feet wide and she's walking around and I have to just move with her. Yeah. And it turned out incredible. It's in a bunch of film festivals right now.
Hmm.
They're trying to pitch it to maybe be a full length movie. But like the human sex trafficking thing is like pretty shocking. Like how it happens in RVs. I didn't know any of this until I shot it. Happens a majority of time in RVs at sporting events and like, you know, in San Diego and like Texas, because
what do you mean?
They blend in with everybody else in the RV.
Yeah, like tailgating and shit.
Like tailgating, like, oh, you want to bang this chick, whatever?
I think it's more like kidnaps and transactions.
They grab the people there.
Yeah, things like that. And really? it's like millions a year. It's like what? Pretty
people
high numbers.
Disappear at these free tailgate points.
Mm-hmm. How old are these people being sex
trafficked?
Do they range
from little kids to you know,
adults?
They can get pregnant. You know, the film that I shot was about they kidnap a woman that is pregnant, and they're basically like going to have to keep her baby but get rid of her. So that was a pretty like mind-blowing thing to shoot, because I never shot a narrative, you know. And my buddy Leo brought me on, and he's just like, hey, we need a gimbal operator, so you're gonna shoot this. I was like, dude, I've never done this before. And he's like, it's okay, you got it. And I was like, okay, and I did it, and it worked out. But
don't
wait,
the director will tell you what he wants.
Yeah, it was really scary to shoot, but I love going and shooting stuff outside of skating.
Of course.
Because I mean, dude, the whole night before I sit there and I'm like, oh my gosh, am I gonna be able to do this? Like, you know, am I gonna mess this up?
Right.
And I love the pressure of that, because the achievement feels so good. And
someone pulling focus for you?
Yeah, somebody's pulling focus from outside the RV.
What camera? Reds?
Yeah, I was on a Red with the gimbal, and yeah, somebody's pulling
focus. A gimbal
focus
is like a steering wheel type thing.
Yeah, it was like a big steering wheel, and it's basically keeps the camera steady.
Movie
or
Ronin or whatever.
Yeah.
Right.
So and there's even one scene too where like they fight on this bed, and I have to like get on the bed, and I'm kind of like moving around with them. And you almost, it's funny, cause like, I think if you could film skateboarding, you could film anything, because you work with so many different personalities and everything's so unexpected.
And you're in different types of environments.
Yeah. And that's not, I didn't learn that until I shot the motorcycle on the wave, because it was like, wait, this is different. You have to go with the situation. And filming that kind of stuff, you have to think two steps ahead.
Right.
You know, when I film Wes Kramer, he's not there telling me like, okay, hey man, like, so I'm going to go and this is where I'm going to do my line and this and this. It's like, I have to look at his eyes and I have to just be like, oh, he's like looking at that. I should set up and be ready.
Yeah.
And then like, or Evan, you show up to a spot and he just does 5-10 tricks immediately. So you have to be ready.
Right. Yeah.
So it's like, I love live sport events. I love the pressure of not being able to like talk to like an NFL player and be like, hey dude, that jumping up and down in the tunnel that you're doing, and the, you know, can you do that for me? Like, I want to be like, I'm gonna get that.
Yeah.
So I love doing that stuff.
Were you the only camera operator?
I was the only camera operator in there. So scary.
That was it.
Was
there any time where you're like, with your little walkie-talkie?
I had
like,
a headset.
I gotta reshoot that. I don't think I got that.
No, but there was times where like they would switch up what they did, and I almost wanted to be like, hey guys, this isn't what we're supposed to do. But I like had to hold myself.
Oh, back. You mean the actors would kind of freestyle?
Yeah, like in one scene they didn't fight, and I was like,
what do I do?
Am I about to jump on the bed, or am I? Yeah, and I just had to follow them and kind of work with it, and it was interesting.
But they probably have like a tarot deck running from your camera to the.
They do out there. They're previewing. Yeah. I mean, there's a whole entire crew outside the RV. Yeah. But
so they know if they got the shot or not.
Right.
Yeah. Well, they wanted it to be one continuous take.
Yeah.
But so we shot 15 of them, and it was insane. Hopefully, I think the film will be online after the new year.
Okay.
But it's touring film festivals. It's called Stand Still. Yeah. And
sick.
It's pretty. Everybody I've showed it to has been like. Like that's heavy. That's
yeah,
creepy. Like, they're heavy. Very like, okay, thanks for bumming me out. But I'm like, dude, it's if it makes you feel that way, that's good. It makes you it's real.
That's what movies are, right? Yeah. Emotions and stuff. Yeah. Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah, it was cool, man. Like, I know you guys had what was his name on here that shoots all the Curbing 3000 stuff?
And oh,
like,
Tim Dowling.
Tim was on here, and it was cool to hear like how he broke the bubble of everything.
Yeah. We often talk about this skateboarding bubble.
Yeah. You know? I mean, because you spend in skating, it was like we were also tunnel vision for so long.
Yeah.
And it was like, this is the only thing that's cool and important. Mm-hmm. And like,
unfortunately, you don't get paid doing it.
Yeah. And like everything's so whack outside of it. But then, you know, like again, like DC presenting these opportunities, I was like, wait a minute, like, dude, filming motocross is awesome. I'm liking this.
But it's also evolving and getting in and going out of your comfort zone, right? You do something for fucking 10 years. You're like, let me try something else.
Yeah, I don't get nervous filming skateboarding. No. But dude, to film anything else, I mean, I like, you can ask my wife. I sit there all the night before. I'm just like, I got this, right? Can I do this?
She's like, you should stick to skateboarding. You're stressing me out
now. She's just like, you say this every time. You can do it. But that's the pressure. And that's the same questions I had when I was doing the Transler videos.
There you go.
I would be like, oh my gosh, like, am I going to be able to do this? And she's like, you got this.
Right.
And it felt good to prove myself to do it.
There you go.
Yeah.
What is it like going to film those other things? And then coming back to skating.
Dude, it's crazy. It's crazy. Yeah. It's definitely, it's interesting to one day be filming like a movie thing, then filming a music video and then next day I'm out with like, you know, Chase Webb and he's grinding a big rail. They're all so different, but because of all the personalities in skating that you deal with, they're so different that you like, it gets you warmed up for it, you know, but it's like, it's also been nice too that, to learn how to like please somebody else's vision, right? Because that's really difficult.
Okay. Yeah.
It's really difficult to like to be willing to do that,
right?
You know, because when you grow up as like a skate filmer, it's like you kind of get to do whatever you want.
Yeah, and it becomes second nature. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, this rail, I'm going to shoot it from here because it's probably it looks the best. Yep. I'm going to get the best bang for my buck. But then now it's a movie. It's a whole different ball game.
Totally. I walked out of the movie thing and I told the guy, I was like, damn, that was crazy. I'd never done that before. He goes, you did absolutely amazing, but don't tell anybody that. And I was like, okay. he's like, you've been doing this for years.
Right.
And he's like, that skateboarding stuff, you used to film that. Now you're doing this. And I was I don't think I'm done yet, but
Well, it's nice to know that you
just
can
do both.
I love having like another option because, I'm not going to film skateboarding forever.
Sure.
And I want to evolve and do other stuff. So to be able to have those opportunities to do side things is like really important to me because, I mean, dude, this industry could crash and burn. I don't know. You know what I mean?
It's not like crash and burn. It's just,
but it goes
always,
in waves.
It's evolving. It's always younger kids coming up taking
it. It's changing, man. And I've always accepted that, and I've always gone with it. I mean, dude, at one point, my job was to just film skateboard tricks, and then when the video came out, I was taking it off of YouTube.
Yeah,
and I didn't understand. I was like, wait, this. They're putting in a secret name, and it's Sean Malto's part, and it has 60,000 views in like the first day, but yet we're selling 20,000 DVDs. Like this is like the world is changing, and I'm like, we need to sell sponsorship dollars versus view counts instead of hard copies.
Yeah.
And that was like actually one of the reasons I left Transworld, because I didn't see that change happening where I was like, this is
a tough one though for any brand though.
It is.
Yeah. I still think brands are still trying to figure the goddamn internet out and stuff.
Totally.
I mean, it's also like you still gotta deal with like music rights and whatever else. Like usually if you put it online, like you have to buy like 2 year or like
absolutely
lifetime, that's probably true. Like
that's what I deal with at DC is we're paying like, you know, per year for a song.
Yeah.
And the whole thing got really difficult, even to where, I mean, dude, it's crazy to look back, but when I would ask people to do stuff even for like the Transworld website, back then it was like that meant it was garbage. So like, because there was that time where if something went to the website, it meant that it wasn't good enough to be in the video.
Yeah.
And people straight to web.
Yeah. And then I saw it kind of changing where I'm like, dude, this is getting more view counts than the DVD. Yeah. And yet I made this in like 2 days.
But the thing with the DVD, seriously, what you don't realize though too, is like someone bought it.
Multiple people are watching.
Multiple people watching.
Yeah,
but dude, like,
you can't.
Yeah.
Online, you have those hard numbers.
Yeah, right? Totally.
You know,
you don't know there was fucking. Like,
but still, even online,
one video.
Even for this show, skate shops say like, oh yeah, dudes come in and we all watch the Nine Club. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
Our views are really double.
Yeah.
You know, just let you guys know.
I think that the...
We're killing it.
Yeah, we're killing it.
You guys are killing it.
We're packing skate shops, bro.
Dude, just saving me in traffic, that's for sure. Sometimes I feel like I'm not just a filmer, I'm an Uber driver. I think you should offer everything. I think, you know, whatever can be seen out there, then that's like what's important.
Well, that was one thing with this show that I wanted it to be everywhere. I wanted it to, if you turned on a radio, I wanted you to be able to find it.
Yeah, in the very beginning you said that.
Yeah, you know, the video is a different thing because YouTube is kind of the... Mm-hmm. You know, Vimeo is, it's harder to search. It's a whole different platform, but audio, there's so many podcast platforms, and I want everybody to turn on something and be able to click on the Nine Club.
Totally.
Yeah.
That's what I saw happening. I was like, hey, I want to be the web filmer. And they're like, you can't, that's for garbage. And I was like, no, more people are going to see my work. I have some ideas. And then just I
let's not put out garbage. How about that?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That's what I was thinking. Yeah.
And, it's hard, I think, a company that big.
At that time, though.
At that time, there was nothing but garbage
like being put on the web.
Yeah, for sure. I think it's hard for a big company like that that's making these videos. It's hard just to understand to switch when nothing's
well,
like that.
Well, plus they're investing money into these videos.
Yeah.
And totally. Now you're asking
a return on the investment.
Yeah, now you're asking me to give this shit away for free.
And it was the coolest thing about the company.
Yeah.
So they're like, wait a minute. You're telling us that the coolest thing about the company isn't working?
Right.
And I'm like, I can't beat the YouTube kids. They're like, they're putting secret codes in and I can't find the parts. Like, this is killing
me. How are they getting it even around,
though? And that was before, like, they had the algorithm to find those, like, parts, you know?
Eventually, yeah.
Yeah.
At that point, it wasn't. It was me, like, going through and being like, Sean Malto's name backwards or something, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, but how are these kids finding these videos? Like, is there like a
forum?
Like
huh?
Yeah, like
message boards and stuff. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Twitter, maybe?
I don't think they were tweeting it out. Was around yet.
Oh.
So, like, when I worked at Dwindle about 3 years ago, whatever, I noticed that, like, you know, social media started really becoming a thing, and like you would drive like an hour to a skate spot, wherever, to meet up with some pro, whoever, and they would just pull out their fucking phones and try and film it for fucking the gram.
Yeah, for sure.
How has Instagram changed your life, or even just changed the way you work?
It's kind of like with everything, I've evolved with it. Mm-hmm. You know, I've always, it's like, again, with like the YouTube kids, I couldn't beat them.
Yeah.
And with Instagram, it's like, I'm not going to fight that because I'm not going to win.
Yeah.
Right.
So I've evolved with it. I mean, I think that there's, it got out of hand a little bit for a while where it was just like everything was straight to Instagram. And then like, or you're filming a really crazy trick and then the homies are there and they're filming it and it's going. But I think that, I think it's a good thing for skateboarding.
Yeah.
Because I think that you can still, I think I could still make videos that just a skater can't make.
Yeah.
And I could put it on social media. I think that it's more exposure. I think that people's short attention span is actually maybe an advantage to us. So if I post a Tiago clip tomorrow that's from his press play part, dude, it will get like so many comments of like, this is the sickest thing ever. And I'm like, dude, this was already came out.
Right. You know
what I mean? Right. So it's like, it's cool that like things don't get, they can get recycled and it's okay.
They can recycle, but also like, they're the dudes who just want to push it out right away.
Well, it depends, you know, because what you say too, what you're doing, Chris, like you're always working on projects.
Mm-hmm.
Like some people that are out skating, like, well, let's say I was skating back then.
Yeah.
I didn't have a project. So you're like, I have nothing to save this for. Let's get rid of it.
Yeah.
Some people, they do that. Or if you're working with them, you usually save their stuff.
Yeah, but if you're going to go out with a dude like who drives across town or wherever, like maybe it's like from Huntington Beach to LA or whatever it might be, and he's there to fucking film you, and then you're like, oh, let me film that real quick on the LCD screen of your camera or whatever, and then you post it on Instagram. Like,
I mean,
you just wasted this guy's entire fucking
time.
But there's
also like, not every trick is like necessarily video part or commercial worthy.
Oh, totally.
So I mean, like, I'm guilty of it too, where I'll go like, I'll take out my GoPro and I'm shooting tricks of these guys because for social media.
Yeah.
Right. Where it's like, I'm trying to evolve with it and not necessarily fight it. I mean,
but you're doing it. It's not like you did the work and then someone else basically poaches your shit and fucking posts
it. That's true.
Out,
it's true.
I mean, that's pretty nuts. Someone records your screen and they post the footage.
That doesn't happen too often, really. But it's more.
But there was a point in time where it was happening and it was like, dude, the fuck's going on?
Yeah. But I mean, it's.
I think people have gotten past that now, you know, for the most part, right?
That didn't happen too much. Like, you know, that really did not happen a lot.
But it's true, though. I mean, like, the going from making a full-length trans roll video to actually like, putting stuff on the web.
Yeah.
You know, it's like this shift has come where companies will spend money now and then just pretty much give their videos away.
Yeah.
You know, it just, it's more exposure, right? Like you said, like in the trans roll video, like you're selling 20,000 copies, but now we're getting 100,000 views, you know?
Yeah. I think you have to constantly evolve and adjust to what's happening. I mean, if you're getting, you want eyes on it, obviously.
Right.
Yeah. So, I mean, like you do want to be able to make money back on hard copies, but I think you, as a brand, you could figure out how can I make money off of this in other ways. So like, sure, we might make a video and give it away for free online.
Mm-hmm. As long as it's promoting
something. It maybe doesn't translate directly to that shoe sold more, but we did sell more, then that helps. But I also think, what I think is really important is there are certain brands that have to constantly be doing stuff. I look at a company like Vans where I'm like, they could do nothing. They couldn't take 5 years to make a video and they're still awesome.
Yeah.
D DC has always been awesome because of what they do, yeah. right? So like if I were to say what's cool about DC, you would say, oh, well, because they did this. That's why DC's always had to keep doing rad shit.
No, I think brands should definitely be doing projects and everything else. Like there's a balance to it all, you know? Like
there is, for sure.
You know, like you can basically go do a tour video and then hold on your best shit for this bigger video and then also take all that footage from that tour video, distribute it on to Instagram and everything else, and I drive it back to that video or whatever else. Like there's like ways to do it.
Yeah, I think we've been, DC for instance has been really smart about the way that they kind of handle it, and it's like it's not just like a blow your load here it all is and that's it. It's like there's a lot of stages to it and a lot of planning, so I've been okay with it. Again, it's like a fight that's just you can't win.
It's never gonna end.
Yeah. But it's like, dude, some days I drive all the way up to Santa Barbara to shoot a trick, and it's like I know that this isn't going to be in a big video. I know this isn't gonna be in the commercial, so I'm gonna shoot it on my GoPro and we're just gonna post it. But that's part of the job too. Yeah. Like my job is to create social videos sometimes, and
as long as
videos,
you guys are still posting.
And same with the skater, for sure.
But like when someone else just posts it randomly, it's like what the fuck did I just drive all
over for? Poaching's a whole nother thing, for sure.
Well, you were saying something that was interesting. What you said, people come work for you, and they mentioned that they had never known what it's like to film like a full-length video.
Yeah, so like, I mean, I've been really fortunate to be the time that like I got into filmmaking and in skateboarding. It was, you know, we were still doing DVDs, and those transfer premieres were huge.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they were huge.
Yeah.
So I got to experience that. Yeah. I got to experience like putting a video on iTunes, like being one of the first few to do that. Being like the first one to really help do it towards the web. You know, so to go through like all those stages, and then I'll have guys that work with me that are just like, hey, what's it like doing a full length? What's it like doing the premiere? And I'm like, that's crazy. You haven't got to experience that, you know? But I'm also very excited that I can upload something now and everybody sees it. I'm excited. True. But maybe it's because I got to experience all that, you know?
Yeah.
But it's also like, I don't hold it to where it's like, it needs to be this old way. It needs to be this way. But it might just be because I got to do all that.
But it's also good for the company too, because sometimes the company could get lost in the old ways too. And it takes somebody like you to be like, no, we got to go forward. We got to follow where the viewers are going, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
And maybe the companies will be psyched that you're on the Nine Club.
You know what's funny is like, I was watching Skate Line, whatever, like on Tuesday. And Gary's all like, oh, Evan Smith just dropped a part for Sony, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, yo, that part was from his fucking Peace video that came out a couple weeks ago. You're like acting like he just dropped this fucking part out of nowhere.
It dropped individually on
Thrasher.
Yeah.
But I just thought it was really weird that like,
maybe he's just saying that like Evan, because Evan should be Sody or something.
Oh, I think he is probably the Sody one for sure. Dude. Like he embodies Sody.
He is my favorite skater.
Yeah,
he's like, amazing,
hands down.
Yeah. What's it like filming with him,
dude? It's incredible. He's like, he's the guy that like he'll go to Pittsburgh and like do work with his uncle or like on their venue and stuff, and then he'll come on a trip with like the same setup, but then he'll get more tricks than anybody else. He's just so involved too, like with the editing and stuff. Like he's got like ideas. Yeah,
he's really into filmmaking.
He's really involved in just the ideas and the concept. Mm-hmm. But I mean, it's also frustrating because like we were doing his time trap part, and he called me on Christmas Day, and he's like, "Hey, dude, I showed my family the video part, and then I didn't feel anything from him, so we got to change the song." And I'm like,
really?
"Evan, your aunt doesn't skateboard, like." Like, I'm sorry she didn't feel anything. Right. And he's like, nope, we have to change the song. And I'm just like, dude, it's Christmas and this thing comes out in like 6 days. He was absolutely right.
Yeah.
Oh, he's really?
Absolutely right. Yeah. We changed the song. And even when I hit up Thrasher and was telling them, they were just like, dude, are you serious? This dude wants to change it. And I'm like, you're telling me I got to redo the whole thing.
Yeah.
So then we did it and I sent the new edit over and they were like, yeah.
Have you ever had like a part that you edited and you were like so psyched on and you show it to the person and they were like, nope.
Yeah, I did one for Tyler Bledsoe for Hallelujah, and it was to this song 40 Daydream.
Kenny Hoyle skated that song.
Kenny Hoyle ended up skating to it after, and dude, it was so good.
That's
and
a good
I loved
song.
It. I loved it was the a song. Great, yeah, yeah, he song. Said it was too poppy, so he wasn't into it. But I think he showed it to somebody else. What kills me is when you're working on a video part or something and you show it to somebody, and they kind of give you a response that's like, dude, you didn't come up with that.
Right.
That was your homie that you showed it to or somebody else.
Sure.
And but usually every suggestion, like any change I've had to make, has always made it better.
Right.
I don't think I've like made an edit to where somebody said to change it and I'm like, dude, that part sucked.
Yeah.
He just didn't like the song. And if he doesn't like the song, we're not doing it.
Yeah.
It's like, that's his part. So, but when I heard it, I was like, dude, I've got the song and the part for you. And he was like, nah. And I was like, ah.
Oh man.
So, yeah.
You mentioned GoPro.
Yeah.
You work for GoPro?
I'm an ambassador. So I do like a lot of their skate stuff, which I
bring you some stuff.
Oh.
Oh.
Look at this,
you
huh?
You got some Hero 7s in there?
GoPro
what the fuck's going on, bro? Look at this, GoPro with some SD cards.
Damn.
Yeah, these guys hooked it up. Like,
wow, thank you, bro.
Kelly, you took
yes.
Thank you, dude.
Yeah.
Thank you. Wow. All
right, I'll take Kelly's. Okay. Just getting Kelly's here. Thank you.
So, these dudes,
this is sick.
David and Neil.
These are, I've been
those are so good.
Are really good.
They're so good. So,
what makes these better than the other
ones?
They
have a really good stabilization.
Yeah, the internal, you don't need the gimbal. I have those
for And the audio is better too, right?
The everything, dude. It can do like Instagram stories. It does so much stuff that, you know, hyperlapses. These poles go
up
too.
Oh, wow.
Here's the thing.
So,
he's got,
So, Davey and Neil hooked this up, man. They like overnight.
Thank you, Davey.
When I told him I was going to be on the show, I was like, hey, can you guys overnight this thing?
Rush, this is your selfie stick. You can use to, a DVD fell right behind him, Rush. Oh. Up there, yeah.
What is that?
Oh, yeah, I got to put that on. Thank you.
That's his hand, by the way.
That's my hand. That's actually, my sweatshirt was brown, but it popped better, so we changed it purple.
Oh, there you go. Nice
Photoshop.
It looks navy.
Yeah, these cameras are insane. I hope you guys like them.
Well, yeah, I'm excited. I know. I actually want to buy one of these.
See, here's the thing. I have a question.
Yes.
Right? I'm a fan of GoPro.
Yeah.
Right. They've sent me a bunch.
We shot the pilot with it.
We did. Oh, yeah, we shot the pilot with GoPros. Right.
And we're like, you know, we can't do this.
But here's the thing. Raj is opening his now. Yeah. I'm trying to get these off the table. No, I'll leave one right here.
Well, we know Roger's not eBaying his if he's opening it.
Well, I like I said, I'm a fan of GoPro.
Yeah.
But I was having issues with them because they were kind of difficult to set up.
Sure.
They were, you know, the juice wasn't worth the squeeze, so to speak. You know what I mean?
They had a couple models that were kind of like difficult to kind of set up with your phone, things like that.
You know?
But these sevens are so
solid. How different are these between the, I think the last one I had was maybe a 4.
No, your mind's going to be blown.
Oh, really?
It's insane. It's so good. I mean, it does, you can do Facebook Live. I think Instagram Live here in the next month or so.
Oh, okay.
It does.
Raj, play the audio, bro.
Yeah.
And the people in the cars are like fucking the guys opening a Christmas
present. Christmas presents every day.
Yeah. It's an unboxing video now.
Go ahead.
I haven't seen him this happy on the show
before. I know.
Dude, I really wanted one of these.
I was stoked because I always thought to myself, like, everybody brings gifts.
Yeah.
And I was just like, what the heck?
Well, not everybody brings gifts.
Not everybody, but it's awesome when they do.
Sure.
And I was like, man, what could I bring? And I was like, oh, if I ever go on one day, I'll bring them some GoPros.
Yeah.
And then, like, I only had 24 hours notice, I think, for this.
Right.
Yeah, I think we put you up on Monday or
Tuesday. Yeah. Like, these guys overnighted the stuff, and I was like, yo, can you hook this up? And they were, like, stoked. So
sick.
They're fans of the show, so it was cool.
Thank you, Neil and...
Davey.
Davey.
Yeah.
Davey and Neil. Yeah, thank you, guys. And thank you for hooking this up.
No,
bro.
You can shoot your cat. You can shoot some POV with the beer. And
whoa.
We've done it
you
before.
You go to the courthouse.
We've done it before.
That's not the only POV Rod's going to shoot, bro. Trust me.
I don't want to see
it. Shit's going to get weird.
Nobody wants to see it, but...
You can film on that, and it uploads straight to your phone.
Yeah, it goes straight to your phone. You can also do like vertical, so straight for Insta story, which is pretty cool. Dude, there's so much stuff. You can do like photos, time lapses, hyperlapses. It's got built-in gimbal, which is my favorite. So basically, you set it on that setting and it looks like the smoothest thing ever.
Wow.
Just set it on that pole and you can go.
Speaking of pole, one of the videos that I like the most is you were filming it was on the hubba through the handles of the rail.
Yeah.
That went off.
Now were you passing it from one hand to another?
Okay. Yeah, so like that was really funny because you know, when I have the camera, it's like the coolest thing about it is that you can fit in so many weird places.
Yeah.
It's like you can get weird with it. I'm not going to stick my red obviously through the railings and break that.
It's a whole thing. It's heavy too.
Yeah. And I didn't know that shot was going to work, but I passed it through the railings and,
but it was so smooth.
It was smooth. And then I didn't think I got the shot.
Uh-huh.
And then, like Riley Hawk and a bunch of, what's their crew's name?
Oh, the
Shep Dogs. All the Shep Dogs showed up and I was too embarrassed to do it in front of them because it looked weird. I was like, had a pole and I'm just like passing it through.
Yeah.
And I was just like, oh, we'll just get it after they leave. And then like they were there forever. And I went home and I was like, oh, the clip we got actually worked.
It worked.
But it was funny because my Apple Watch, I hit it on the railing and I didn't know it, but I broke it getting that shot.
You broke your Apple Watch?
I broke my Apple Watch, yeah.
Oh.
But it was worth it. The shot was awesome. Carlos did switch.
No, it was great. I mean, it stuck out to me.
It was stoked.
I see a lot of GoPro footage.
Yeah.
And that one stuck. Did they post it on their...
They post it on their Instagram and like on their website and stuff. And
boom.
Did, like,
a little tutorial. There you go, bro.
How's the battery life?
Battery life's good.
Really?
How long? Yeah, it is good. All day.
Really?
Yeah.
All day. Good. One battery.
I mean, you'll be fine.
Even with the LCD on.
I mean, don't run it all day, but like if you go out filming and shooting, you'll be fine. Two is great, but one should get you by. If you need more batteries, you guys
don't worry.
You let me know.
I'm gonna need more batteries.
But I get Raj. Yeah.
Raj does long POV shots.
Oh, no, but he skates the sand gaps all the time. Let's get some footage, Raj.
Sure. Yeah.
Thank you.
You want to hold the stick?
No, dude, no problem.
Thank you for this. Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
I'm stoked you guys already don't have one, so that's good.
But the GoPro,
Yeah, so I've been ambassador for them.
Yeah.
You know. It was funny because I think the first person I saw with it was Jason Hernandez.
Mm-hmm.
But before I saw him with it, Oliver Barton hit me up and he's like, hey, dude, like you should look at these new cameras. Like they're really cool. But I didn't really, they was just showing like surfing. So I was like, what am I going to do with this thing?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, right. I don't
put
know.
Put it on her board.
Yeah. And then, well, and then I saw Jason had one and we were kind of like looking at it and still confused on kind of like what you do with it.
Sure.
And then I met up with the dudes from GoPro. I think they had like 14 employees at the time and they gave me, they're like, here's a box. Figure something out. John Hall and I put it underneath the skateboard. That was like the opening shot in Hallelujah and people went nuts at the premiere. And then,
and then everyone,
they blew up overnight. Like they, I mean, not from skateboarding, but like,
but everyone had the same shot.
It did.
Yeah, I got sick of it, enough already guys.
Yeah, yeah. I got sick of it for sure. And then, yeah, they blew up overnight and then it was a few years went by and they hit me up like, hey, we want to like do stuff with skateboarding again. Or we'd be interested in like, you know, doing some stuff. And I was like, absolutely. Like, I'm a huge fan of the brand.
You know what GoPro needs to do?
Hmm.
They need to make these nanny cams.
That's
good. They need to have a motion sensor in here.
Right.
So that way, like, if someone enters a room, whatever, you can just kind of record what's going on.
Like a Nest camera.
Yeah, like a Nest camera or whatever. Like, that's the only thing that's missing from these things.
But you actually...
I think they could sell a lot of these to fucking parents.
Probably, yeah. I don't know. I'm stoked on this one. Yeah. And they've been, we do like these trips every year too that are just insane. Like went to New Zealand, went to Greece recently,
there you go.
Japan, and it's like it's different than any other skate trip because they'll be like 3 days skating and then like the next 3 days they're like, hey, we want to go do fun adventure stuff.
Oh, cool.
So like jet skis and cliff jumping and bungee jumping and so on. So
put
it's like
GoPro in weird places.
Yeah, it's like it's weird to go on a skate trip and like
go do
they're
shit.
Like go have fun and it's like
is it weird going on a skate trip and not bringing your rig cam?
It's the coolest thing.
Like,
though.
You don't have like a bag of these.
Yeah, I just get I get way more stuff because it's just smaller and
it's just easy. You could and it's not intrusive
and anyone can
use it.
Just basically pass it off to fucking like Brophy or whoever else.
Exactly.
Like,
Brophy and Malto, those dudes are always on the trip and it's like, dude, everybody's the filmer, you know what I mean? And then when they're not skating, they're filming, so it's rad.
I'll send GoPro my portfolio, man.
Have you used this with the gimbal system?
You don't need a gimbal now. Not at all.
Yeah.
You do not need a gimbal now.
Yeah.
That's what's crazy.
That's nuts.
Rogers is just as excited when Brad brought the neon sign.
Because like when they add the gimbal system inside of it, whatever, I'm like, that's kind of sick, but I wonder how really well it works, you know?
I didn't believe it. When they told me about it, I was like, there's no way.
Yeah.
And then I used it and I was like, okay.
Give Raj a camera, man. Yeah. He's fucking stoked.
You know.
GoPro, DC. Who else, is it anybody else you
with? I do some like a lot of freelance stuff.
Okay.
I mean, like my friends, the Krillix, they have a production company. I do stuff for NFL Films.
Oh wow.
Eric Longden that you guys work with on this show, he's hired me for stuff.
Okay.
It's basically a lot of people just hit me up having, you know, shooting the cool stuff I've got to.
When do you want to, we're all skateboarders.
Yeah.
Is there a point in time where you're like, okay, I've popped the bubble.
Yeah.
Let me now exit the bubble and let me go and
that's a hard question to answer now, dude.
Well, you don't know though. He's doing all kinds of different stuff, man. You know, I'm just asking, is there a point, do you see yourself in the near future? exiting skateboarding and going.
I always said I'd film skating until I was 35.
35.
35.
How old are you?
He's 37.
35. I just turned 35.
You just turned 35.
Oh. Yeah.
Okay, but still, we're 35 is still young. Raj, please. Bro. I mean, goddamn, they're beeping over here. He's turning it on. He's ready to shoot his POV, whatever it is, in his bedroom.
I'm enjoying the gift he gave us.
Dude. Next time, give it at the end of the show, yeah. Chris. Raj, Jesus Christ, bro. Should I go into a commercial break while you're playing with that thing? GoPro.
The commercial break.
The smallest camera in the world, huh? Buy GoPro. Kelly, use a GoPro, huh?
Yeah,
there
I love
you
it.
Go, huh? GoPro. There's your commercial. Yeah. So, what the fuck was I saying, man?
Oh, about leaving skating.
You said 35, but you're 35 now.
Yeah.
But you still have a lot of shit going on in skating.
I do, yeah.
But you have a lot of shit going on outside of skateboarding.
I want to know how you got involved with NFL Films.
Dude, that was crazy. And it's funny. So this kind of answers both those questions because, you know, you're right. You can't film skating forever.
Yes, you can.
Once a skater, we're always going to be skateboarding. We've got to move on, right?
Yeah. And you know what? I'm in a weird situation where I'm really like fulfilled. So I've got to do like everything that I wanted to do.
Okay.
And when I first got hired for skating, mm-hmm. my biggest fear was having to go back to that normal warehouse job and not being able to complete everything that I've wanted to in my career.
Sure.
I didn't want to get hired and then like blow it at Lakai a month later and then I'm out.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So to go this long and to film the people I have and the projects I have, super thankful. If it ended tomorrow, mm-hmm. I'm so happy. So happy. So to be in that situation is pretty rare, especially at 35. I started to think a few years ago, I was like, man, what else do I like outside of skating? Because mm-hmm. I think you should work with what you love.
Totally.
And I was like, well, I really love football. I really like sports. So I went on LinkedIn and mm-hmm. searched NFL Films and said I had a connection. And I was like, that's really weird. Like, I know somebody.
How does LinkedIn? I'm not on LinkedIn.
So if you're like friends,
what do you mean
like,
a connection?
Well, so like if you're friends with somebody that works for that company, it basically says like you know somebody work here.
One of your friends
works there. Yeah. And I had no idea. I was like, wait, how do I know somebody with NFL Films? So I messaged the guy and his name's Phil Gush. So I hit him up and I was like, hey man, like I filmed skateboarding, kind of told my whole story. But one day
we're friends.
Yeah. No, he hit me right back and he's like, dude, I know exactly who you are.
Oh wow! Did you know him or were you
just?
Didn't
know him. No, he just
befriended you.
He knew me from Transfer Video, and I had bought footage from him from Pete Eldridge's part because he's from Philly. Yeah.
He's a skateboard filmer.
Yeah, and he was a skateboard filmer and then went off to NFL. And he's good friends with Chris Cole and that whole crew.
Okay.
So he's like, hey dude, if you go film a high school game or any college game, mm-hmm. I'll get you in the mix. And I didn't really persuade that because I wasn't ready to leave skating.
Okay.
Because I thought like, oh, if I go over there, that means I'm done.
Right.
That means I have to go work for NFL. And then I saw him a couple years ago. We were on a DC tour through Philly and he actually met us at the spot and he mentioned, hey man, I'm going to be in Irvine shooting the Rams Hard Knocks. Would you be interested in coming out and doing a tryout? And I was like, dude, that's my backyard. I kind of have to.
Right.
Like, this is perfect timing. And I went out there and, you know, past the tryout, basically.
Okay.
I had to go film a game and they were like, you know, if you can get 5 shots for this first TV episode, you absolutely nailed it. So the very first shot, out of a whole game. Yeah. So I was kind of like Weasel Cam that just floats around and gets like whatever, like fan reactions that they can cheat in throughout the whole show.
Yeah.
And the very first shot, they had me go and film like a helicopter pass by the stadium. So I'm filming up there and the helicopter goes by and it wasn't a very cool shot.
Did they know the helicopter was going to pass?
Yeah, they knew.
By?
They used it.
No, they didn't use it. But the kickoff was happening. I figured, well, since I'm up here, I'll film the first kickoff in LA in 20 years. So I filmed the kickoff. I'm thinking in my head, they'll cut to the player when he catches the ball, and then they got the first kickoff from the top
wide
view.
Yeah, bird's eye.
But the dude catches it, and he just runs across my screen and scores a touchdown.
Oh, wow.
And I looked over the PA and I was like, dude, I think we got our first shot. Like, that was insane. Like, that happened.
How many other guys are filming this game?
There's a big crew. It's like for a show that they're doing. And there was, but I'm the only one that's like Weasel Cam kind of floating around. Okay. They're assigned to like players that are wired. They're assigned to bench. They're assigned to coaches. And then I got, I think it was like 9 or 10 shots in that episode.
Oh, wow.
And then the next one, I kind of knew like what they were looking for. And I had like 29 shots. I'm a nerd. And
I mean, from five to 29. I mean,
yeah. Geez, and then, yeah. Great. And then I've been doing stuff with them, since here and there, whenever they need me.
Okay. And they're over here in Culver City, right?
No, that's NFL Network. So I've done one project for them, but NFL Films is on the East Coast.
Okay.
And that's one of those like passion companies where I'm just like, dude, if something were to pull me away from skating like tomorrow, it would be NFL Films like calling me, you know?
Right.
But because I'm on the West Coast and there's such a disconnect, I don't know if I'm there enough in their like radar. And it's funny because you, like in skateboarding, like,
but they got any West Coast dudes because there's teams over here now.
But it sounds one of those jobs too, you'd be traveling a lot.
Yeah, it'd be cool.
You'd be going from game to game to game.
Yeah, I did the Rams Hard Knocks, and the next year they had me on.
What's a Rams Hard Knocks?
So it's a show on HBO that's like more of a documentary style.
Gotcha.
And then the next year it was the Cowboys. So I went all
each
their
season
way.
They go to different teams. Okay.
And they kind of assign you to a team, so the people there are like familiar with seeing your face, or, and you know the rules, and you know each team's different.
What's that phone called? Hydrogen or something? What's it called?
They calling?
Wouldn't know it.
This is the hydrogen. Yeah.
Hydrogen phone.
Yeah.
Your hydrogen phone rings right now.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
NFL Films. Hello.
So big, by the way.
Chris Ray. Hello. This is Bert from NFL Films.
Phil.
Man.
Phil.
Sorry, Phil. This is Phil from NFL Films.
Yeah, Bert.
We want you for the whole season. Mm-hmm. You kind of got to drop everything. Mm-hmm. We're going to fly you from game to game to game. We have this whole thing planned this year. Yeah. You're our man. You got 29 shots in the last episode.
You're our A Weasel Cam.
You know?
Cam.
Huh? A Weasel Cam. Cam A.
And just for the record, I'm like the bottom of the barrel. I'm there like...
This is the call.
Way better,
this is the call.
This is the call. Phil,
way
Phil is on the phone.
Yep.
Do you put him on hold? Do you say, hold on a second?
You don't
put Phil
on hold.
No, you don't put Phil on hold. Okay.
Yeah, put him
Phil's not on. Do you call Phil back? Do you say, let me think about this?
I answer every call.
Do you let Phil sweat a little bit? Say, Phil, let me think about this, Phil.
No. I mean.
You're accepting the job.
Oh, man. DC is going to watch this and be like.
This is hypothetical.
They're never going to let me take another NFL job. You know what?
We want to give you $250,000 a month. A year. A year.
Then absolutely I'm doing a Phil.
I'm in, Phil. No,
you're
I don't
a
know.
Bad negotiator.
I don't know how much people get paid for these things. I have no fucking clue, you know?
I'll tell you this. I've never worried about the money. Because if what you're doing, what you love, the money will follow.
Exactly.
So, I mean, obviously, I need to take care of my family, and there needs to be a number to get me there.
Yeah.
But passion is way more important and doing what you love is way more important. If it was about the money, I'd be a doctor or a lawyer or something. I don't know.
Oh, there you go.
So, yeah. But it's not. I want to be a filmmaker. If they called me today and it was a do this, I mean, dude, it would be really tough.
Here's the thing too, is like, hey, do this for one season, NFL football season, and maybe we'll hire you for the next season. We don't know. So now you're taking this big risk of like, here's this DC that I have year round,
guaranteed
every year. Yep. I don't know how long you have a contract for, if you have a contract, but, and now, I mean, how do you know what I mean?
It's a risk.
Phone call from Phil may come. I'm just trying to get you ready. I'll be Phil. Hello.
Hey, just like that
Chris,
phone call.
Phil.
I know. Phil, what's up, dude?
I want to put you on this season. You have to drop everything you're doing. Okay. You may not get in next season.
Mm-hmm.
You got 29 shots in this last episode, bro. We think you're a Weasel Cam.
Yeah.
What do you say?
I would have to say yes, but I will say this in DC's sake. I would make sure that the transition is smooth. I would make sure, you know, those guys have done a lot for me. It's hard to say yes.
You would jump off the bridge. You would try. You would have to. Next season is not.
It's not. NFL
seasons are, you know, they're short,
sure,
right?
For sure.
How many games do they play? 16?
16 weeks plus playoffs.
There you go.
But there's stories in between all that stuff.
Oh, there. So. Okay, for sure.
It's there's enough.
Yeah.
And I would like that example of a phone call excites me to take that risk because that's what gets me excited. To leave DC would give me like a it's scary,
right?
It's scary because
of course
because I love those guys, you know what I mean? And Well, but you're also asking me for like the dream company.
Yeah, yeah, that's your dream.
Like,
yeah.
Like do that same phone call, but be something else. You could be like baseball company, and I'd be like, nah, okay. I'm not interested. Yeah. So we are talking.
This is Bob from MLB.
Bob, I think baseball is boring. I'm not doing it.
Okay, okay. So, yeah. Thanks for your time.
Yeah. But it pays really fucking well.
Yeah, but it's not, I'm not concerned about the money. It's, yeah. It's what I love to do. But I do have this passion for football, just like I do skateboarding.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
It's a... It gets me excited.
I would let Phil sweat a little bit.
Yeah,
I would say. I would say, hold. Let me call you back, Phil.
I hope I'm not going to get in trouble at DC now.
This is just me being hypothetical. I know, but
they're going to call me and be like, "Oh, how loyal are you?" I'm going to get dirty looks for the team writers now.
We're having fun here.
I know.
Bro.
I know.
You know, we're having
Phil's
fun.
Phil's going to love this.
Well, how did you get a job at DC? How did you start working there?
So that one was interesting because I was at Transworld and I was like, you know, I was kind of like ready to move on, I think, and kind of find. It evolves like that's what everybody else there kind of did before. And I was looking for like that team, that home and like a set place. So I remember hitting up Jeff Taylor and I was like, hey, I'm going to go work for Etnies because I'm good friends with Mikey and I'm good friends with Malto. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of all in the works and happening. And then I came down, I skated with Mikey and Malto and they were like, oh, hey, like
we're all quitting.
DC's talking to you also, but like you should think about what they're doing. And I'm like, that's really weird that you guys are telling me to go work for DC.
Yeah.
When like I'm trying to film you guys. So right. I was like, okay, if you guys don't want me to film you, like I guess that's okay. It's weird.
Yeah.
But then I figured out like, oh, they're all going to DC. Malto at one point was maybe going to go there.
Yeah,
so, right. So he was maybe going to go there and then Mikey was going, Mike Mo was going. So I kind of went over there with that crew. And that's just how I ended up there, you know, and okay. I wanted something different. I wanted, I always grew up as a fan of the brand. I mean, I was like the first kid in my school to have DCs.
Oh, wow.
I followed the company. Like,
Josh Callis, Steve Williams.
Absolutely.
I mean, the list is huge.
I mean, the dream sponsors, like growing up as a kid was like chocolate, DC. Okay. Like that was like the companies.
Wow. Did you say Josh Callis?
It's funny whenever you know people say that.
I always get confused now because Stephen Callis, Josh Callis.
Yeah.
I always word fart it or whatever it's called, you know? Yeah.
Callis.
Yeah.
Whatever, dude. You know what I'm saying? If he's sitting in that chair, I'll get it right.
You got to get Callis on the show, dude. Yeah, he'd have so many good stories.
Hell yeah.
We've had Callis.
Yeah.
Time to get Callis.
Yep, exactly. Exactly. So yeah, I went over there and... you know, just been doing their video since I've been working with their team and that evolved into, again, like doing non-skate stuff
right.
Where they were like, and that was when I got the red camera and they were like, oh, hey, we need to borrow your camera to shoot this moto thing. And I was like,
how about I go shoot it?
I was like, I'll go shoot it. I don't want to give it up. So,
yeah.
So then I would go and shoot it and I realized, wow, this is really fun. Yeah. And Jeff Taylor pushed me in that direction of like opening my eyes to other stuff and other opportunities and like, hey dude, like you could make some more money doing this and like you should go and like reach out to this person and try to do the side job. And all the side jobs I've done, I've like learned something and taken it back to DC.
Well, I was gonna say like doing all these other things, a movie and filming this guy on the even then that was a DC thing, filming the guy on the water, the motorbike on the wave. I mean, you bring back so much knowledge that benefits them.
Totally.
You know?
And I mean,
like,
dude,
it makes you better.
Jeff did the same thing for me. Like,
totally.
When Viva La Bam came about, he's like, dude, do it.
There you go.
Yeah. And I just brought it back to audio as well.
Yeah. You know? I think if Phil did call from NFL Films, I think you could maybe work something out with Phil saying, hey, you know, let me, I'm going to do this DC thing. Yeah. Maybe I could fly out, do a game. Mm-hmm. Fly back, do the DC thing. You know what I mean?
That's what we.
And then you bring the knowledge back to DC, and you'd make some. I mean, Jesus Christ!
That's kind of what we've been doing already.
Yeah.
You know, it's like I'll come in and just do like a job for a day or two, and then I come back, and it's like I'm on DC for the next month.
Dude, it raises your level, bro.
Yeah. I mean, dude, look at Atiba, and I'm like, that dude is shooting basketball covers.
Oh yeah.
I showed up to an NBA shoot just recently for like JBL, and I go out there, and dude, who's on set when I go out? In Milwaukee?
Yeah.
Atiba and Ty Evans.
Right.
No way.
Wow.
I was like, you have got to be kidding me. These agencies are getting smart. They're hiring these like skate people that can do everything.
Oh yeah.
So I'm on set with these two legends that I admire and I'm like, this is inspiring.
That's
like
dope.
And it does make them more valuable because I look at even like Mike Blayback. That dude is shooting like Ford commercials and he shoots the best skate photos. So it's like
it's a win-win.
Totally.
I don't want you to stop making skate videos. I'm just having fun.
Appreciate
I'm just having fun with you.
You kind of got me scared.
No, don't be. I like. We're just riffing.
You need a balance.
We're just riffing.
No, for sure. And it's I guess it also depends on like my mood of the day or the week of what projects I'm in, you know?
I thought it was cool. I was looking at your story the other day. Like, oh, you're out filming some football thing.
Yeah.
And then next day you're out skating, bond doing something with Chase Webb.
Dude, exactly.
I
was like,
that's sick.
Yep. I trip out on that. I think that's hilarious.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like that I can go film a football player and then Chase is grinding some big rail. Yeah. And I'm just like, I'm like, how sick is that?
That's amazing.
Yeah. I love it, bro. Yeah.
What's it like filming Tiago?
Tiago's the best, dude. He's the best. He's like, dude, his parts, like his press play part is definitely one of my favorite parts I've ever done.
Mm.
For sure. Yeah. He's the best. He's the guy that he'll go to a spot and he'll do the gnarliest trick. And then
longer and further,
he'll step it up. Yeah, he'll step it up. Yeah. And you're like, dude, you just did the craziest trick. And now he's going to take himself out. He already did the best trick at the spot.
Wow.
So yeah, he's like, he's a filmer's dream. He's super thankful and humble. And
I was going to say, it seems like he's always having fun.
Yeah.
He's just always just, he's got that demeanor.
Happy-go-lucky.
Demeanor. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, he's incredible.
Oh. Who's your favorite filmer?
Favorite filmer? I would say...
You know, Raj is sitting right next to you. And you know,
it's all good.
I mean, dude, Ty Evans has been an inspiration for sure. Right. Jason Hernandez. Oh, like, yeah. I mean, those guys have pushed it so far in different ways.
Don't forget Ricky.
Ricky's the man, dude.
Ricky who?
Ricky Benenbaugh, dude.
Oh, there you go.
He's filming at Fox. He works for Jeff Taylor.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's filming Moto, yeah.
Oh, whoa.
Yeah.
Any advice out there for other up-and-coming filmer? I mean, this day and age, there's a lot of kids filming.
Don't put it all on your credit cards, kids.
Well, oh, God. Raj is still paying his credit cards off. But I mean, like, you know, skateboarding, it's a weird thing. I feel like being a cinematographer, a camera operator, whatever the hell you want to call it, filmer, you know, do what you're doing what you love, obviously, but to make a living at it, it's very hard these days, right? You got to maybe work for a bigger company. Yeah. You got to work for a DC or a GoPro or an Adidas or a Nike or build up your YouTube channel, you know,
I mean, dude,
if what would you say to somebody if they were,
if they're trying to be a skate filmer, first of all, it's like just being a straight skate filmer in the industry doesn't really exist that much anymore.
Yeah.
It's really rare. I mean, you have like a few dudes, but if you can film skating, but you also know how to film an interview, you can film product, you can film a commercial. That's huge.
Okay.
Like that makes you valuable. Yeah. Like that's the dude that I want to hire because I can throw him out on a skate session and it's not weird. And he can also
shoot product.
Yeah. He could shoot a women's video. You know what I mean?
He can do it.
Yeah. If you're trying to just be a straight up filmmaker, like, dude, I still take free jobs because I want the experience, the connections. I want to meet people.
Totally.
And there's things I don't want to shoot for my reel that I might not have, you know? And those things have helped a ton. You know, the second you do a couple free jobs, everybody's like, okay, you're solid. I'll pay you. Let's do this, you know?
Or people just call you for free. This guy worked for free.
That's a problem too, though. By offering free, you just...
Yeah, I mean, you have to...
Depends on the project.
Yeah, it depends on the project.
If Spike Jones is like, hey, man, I need a... but we need a little
Spike called me like
I need a weasel
example. Spike calls you, it's like, dude, of course I would do that for free.
Sure.
Like that would be insane,
right?
You know, but if somebody's taking advantage of you, you can tell.
Of course interviews,
I think, just like
being an all-around person,
being an all-around, like able to kind of do everything, makes you more valuable. Being able to edit to you. We do a lot of edits. I mean, dude, like DC pumps out like, I mean, dude, we're working on like sometimes 40 videos a month, and some of those are only internal, some are on Amazon, some are on the website, some are just straight for social, some are for third-party media outlets like Thrasher.
You're fucking
like
busy.
We're really busy.
How much does internal videos piss you off?
You know what? They used to really upset me, but now it's like, again, evolving with that thing. So it's like, I try to make the internal video
good enough to be put out.
Yeah. And like, even when we go do a shoot, people will be like, oh, this is just internal only. And I'm like, it's never just internal only.
Yeah.
You have to make this video good.
For everybody. Yeah.
And it may leak out. So let's make it good enough to where if it does leak out. So we've gotten smarter with that whole process, but I'm sure with working for audio and things like that, you experienced sales meeting videos.
Sales meeting,
There was like, when I worked at Dwindle, there was a few internal videos. I'm like,
but dude, I have the best crew. Yeah. Like the DC Films crew is so solid that those dudes can pump out videos nonstop. Yeah. Like that's the other thing, is like surround yourself with a really solid crew, because it's not a competition.
Yeah.
It's about having a team.
Yeah. You all work together.
Exactly. Yeah. And like, I've never like looked at somebody and been like, oh, they're better than me. I don't want them to work with me because they're going to outshine me. It's like, no, I want that person to work with me because they're going to inspire me. Yeah. You know what I mean? The crew that I have at DC is like, inspires me every day.
It's funny, like, to work harder. When I was coming out, like filming whatever, having like a second angle was never a thing.
Totally.
And then like slowly evolved to like, hey, you want to grab a second angle?
Dude, yeah. I would on a sesh before. I've seen it like where there's a gnarly trick going down. And the dude's filming it, and the other guy's like, hey, I'm going to shoot this second angle. He's like, nope, no, you're not.
Nope.
You're not filming that.
Yep. And
like, I was like, wow.
Yeah.
There was
it was pretty gnarly at one point in time.
Yeah.
And then, like, they realized, oh, wait, we can all work together and fucking cover this thing properly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's important. Yeah. I think people, like, in film school and stuff will probably be like, oh, I don't like that guy because he's really good or something. I mean, skaters do it to each other. Skater doesn't like another skater because he's really good. And it's like, dude, that guy's going to make you better.
Even talk show host, man.
Even talk show host. You guys got a good solid career. You don't got any weak links here. You guys are good.
We got one weak link. What?
What?
Said I'm pretty weak.
What the fuck are you talking about, Raj? God damn it. Guy's going to go shoot his POV video for 20 minutes.
I'm going to start doing my own selfie videos.
Watch out, bro.
He's going to start texting us all these weird videos soon.
I'm going to start vlogging.
No, but it's true what you're saying, though, having the tight crew. We do have a tight crew around here. You know, Roger and I have a good...
we have a good work relationship.
We have seamless, you know, it's like he does... You know, he does what he do. I do what I do. We share projects. Like, it works beautifully.
Totally.
And then there's Kelly.
Huh?
And then there's Kelly.
And then there's Kelly.
I'm just over here with the button.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the only thing that ties me to anything,
He's just a social media guy.
Hydrogen phone is ringing. It's Chris Roberts on the phone. They don't like the DC thing you're doing, but, you know, we got something good over here at the Nine Club. You know what I mean?
Huh? Yeah. I like
We're getting a couple bucks from YouTube.
Yep.
Yeah, maybe a couple bucks from the shirts. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, I don't, what do you think?
We got new long sleeves. Huh?
What do you think? Maybe intern here?
I would say I'm gonna stick with DC. Yeah, I'm gonna have to stay with DC.
Okay. I don't blame you. I don't blame
Chris,
you.
Chris, I'm a big fan and we're working on a lot of cool projects over here too. So like, you know,
Anytime you need a talk show host,
dude, we should get you out there for some sales meeting or something. You know, you guys got to come out for something.
I want to be the guy commentating on the motorcycle riding a wave.
We don't do any moto stuff anymore.
Oh
yeah. We're just a skate company now.
Oh, so, really?
Yeah.
I want to see Chris commentate on something. He has no idea what's going on. That would be great.
He's good at bullshitting.
Exactly. That would actually be really funny.
Well, let's we got to wrap this up soon. But you mentioned your kid, right? How old?
Yep. Hensley, he's 5.
Hensley.
Yeah.
Oh, I wonder who you named him after.
Dude, funny thing about that though is that it's technically not after Matt Hensley.
Okay.
Because it's after his bar. So we were driving and I worked with his wife at Transworld for years.
Oh,
she was like an office mom to us. She's the best. Matt Hensley's before my time.
Yeah.
So the importance of him I don't fully like get because he's before my time. So we were driving to San Diego and my wife was pregnant. We don't know what we're having. And she's like, oh, if we have a boy, like Hensley could be a cool name. Cause she saw the bar on the side of the freeway.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, that's actually funny. Cause I know the dude and I know his wife and she actually means more to me than him. So when I saw him at the Pretty Sweet premiere and I was like, hey, I'm about to have a son. If it's a boy, I'm naming Hensley. He's like, that's awesome. I was like, yeah, but not after you.
Yeah. Did you say that?
Yeah. Oh my and he God. Laughed. So I'm probably like the first one to name him Hensley, but it's not directly after Matt, but I was stoked that my wife came up with it and it wasn't
amazing.
Like a like such a skate rat like you know naming my kid after a skateboarder that like she kind of was involved in that, so that was cool.
It's a good name. I like Hensley.
Yeah, he's a good kid.
Yeah,
loves skateboarding. Lego Ninja. He thinks, you know, I hang out with a lot of filmmakers, like they're my friends, they come over and have dinner and stuff, and he just thinks like everybody's a filmmaker
or skater. Really?
Yeah. So it's just funny, like looking at it from his perspective.
Yeah,
it's kind of right.
Yeah, it's funny. So it's pretty crazy.
Listen, bro, this has been amazing.
Dude, thank you for having me.
Dude, thank you. Yeah, I think you Raj loved it the most. It's funny when filmers get together.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like it's a beautiful thing. You know, I must say it's a beautiful thing. Well, Raj got a new GoPro.
I'm a huge fan of the show. You guys are killing it. I mean, it's got me through a lot of traffic.
And I appreciate that, man.
Just,
I appreciate
just to be in this seat like a lot of other people have. It's pretty awesome.
Hey, thanks for what you've done for skateboarding, dude.
Exactly.
You made a lot of
great videos. Yeah.
Great videos.
Worked with a lot of cool dudes. Yeah.
Yeah. And hopefully it won't be then.
No, it's not the end.
Yeah.
I mean, dude, it's just, there's too many cool things that are happening, especially next year at DC. We got some cool stuff.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Some cool stuff lined up that I'm excited about. So I'm gonna do both. I'm gonna do a lot of skate stuff. I'm gonna do a lot of non-skate stuff, mm-hmm. and it's all gonna come out, and it'll be good.
I love it, bro.
You start mashing up NFL stuff and skate stuff,
dude. Right, I need to figure that out. There's actually a Rams running back. He's a skater, so I've been talking to him. Yeah.
Really?
So,
oh yeah,
John Kelly. Yeah,
he's involved.
Okay.
Dude, he's super hyped on skating. I got him a primitive box, and he was stoked. So
that's amazing.
Yeah, just Oliver Barr and I know him well. So I was like, hey, dude,
We'll send him a couple Nine Club shirts.
You should, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah, he'd be hyped. He's like a big P-Rod fan. And
who's not?
Right?
Right.
Yeah. Exactly.
P-Rod.
Exactly.
Kelly, will you please go grab
what size Chris shirt are you?
I'm a large.
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 I'm a large, yep.
Yeah, I will send GoPro my resume. I'd like to get on a couple of those trips.
Hit up Davey, dude.
Davey?
Dude, we got to get you on a trip. That would be sick.
I want to go.
I'd just be talking to the camera the entire time.
I don't know if I bungee jump though. I've seen you guys do that whole shit, and
you have to watch the video of me doing it. I was so scared. I almost didn't go on the trip because that was on our itinerary. I was so scared. I was so pissed we had to do it.
I'm the dude that the rope's gonna break.
Yeah, that's why I said I want to go second.
Yeah,
because I wanted to make sure that the workers were awake for the first guy, and then they didn't snap it.
Right.
Yeah, that's why I went second.
Thank you, Kelly.
You never know though.
I mean, just like I don't skydiving, bungee, like I just, you know.
Yeah.
The rope will break, the parachute won't open, and people, you know.
Trust me, it's my fear too. But GoPro trips are awesome.
They'll have to find a new host.
Easy.
Switch flip. I don't think it'll be that easy, Raj. Switch flip Manny.
Thank you.
Who's on your list, Raj, for replacing me, huh? Rob Brink?
No, Louis.
Louis?
First choice.
Ooh, fucking guy.
That's actually
he's gonna go shoot a POV video with Louis.
That was a really quick response. Have you been thinking about this?
No, that was my first choice. Okay. I end up with this guy.
Like he created this whole show. Here's the warehouse manager.
Yeah.
Here's I joke about, you know, Raj is fucking.
Thank you, dude. These shirts are sick.
Nine Club shirt for you and a large
crew neck.
That's sick.
Bro.
I like that.
All available on the nineclub.com.
We have hoodies as well if you want a hoodie.
By the way, congratulations on the gold medal you won with Mike Mo in the Real Street Part and the silver medal you won with Chris Cole in the Real Street Part.
Yeah, yeah.
Kind of got a thing going over there.
I think I've done like 8 or 9 of those.
And oh, have you?
Always maybe gotten top 3.
Ooh.
Didn't get medals until recently, but
okay.
They usually give watches usually in the past. But we have that coming out. Okay. A lot of stuff from DC coming out. That's pretty cool.
Dope.
Lot of videos. Like I'm looking at the calendar that they have planned and going, and it's a little stressful.
What'd you say? Like 40 something videos a month or something?
Dude, there's a lot. Yeah. We'll do like 40 videos a month. It's shocking. I mean, dude, I told my boss that we had like 45 videos 1 month, and he goes, there's no way. And I was like, well, here's the list. And he goes, whoa, you're not kidding. I was like, this is like usual.
Listen, man, much success for you in the future, bro. Thanks, I know, man. You're going to kill it out there. Thanks. I just hope that you hire me at one point in time.
I'm down.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we can get you on this GoPro trip. We'll talk to Davey.
I think this could happen, dude.
Don't expect them to skate though.
Dude, it's...
Are you kidding me? They do all kinds of shit, Raj.
Yeah, I know. You'd love that.
You hate pointing the camera at your own face.
Bro, I'll be skimboarding.
I'll be filming him. Okay. I'm not skating, so like, I'll film him.
Yeah.
What are you going to do, Chris?
I'll go skimboarding. I'll go fucking ski? No, I don't ski. Did you say ski?
No, we don't ski. We do like...
Skimboarding?
I'll skimboard up the storm.
We'll go to like some famous locations. We'll do like some, really nice dinners.
I could do that.
You know how to eat?
I love to eat.
Okay, there you go.
Yeah.
We'll do swimming, lots of swimming.
I'm not a big swimmer. I got to work up my summer body for that.
Okay. You can be a background guy. Brofield will handle the flips in the water.
I don't do that. In the background at all times, it'd be great. Oh.
Yeah, you'll be good.
Thank you, bro. Chris Ray, bro. You're the man.
Thank you.
Like I said, much success to you in the future. Big fan, and can't wait to see what you do next, bro. It's going to be amazing.
Thanks, man.
You
know, man.
And again, thank you for the GoPros.
No problem.
Yes,
Roger's hyped.
I know. It's rare to see Roger fucking playing with a toy.
He was going to go film mid-episode.
The last GoPro I had, Costin lost it in the surf in North Shore.
Like, oh, Costin did?
Yeah.
Don't let Costin use it, man.
Yeah.
He was like shooting Rofi skimboarding or whatever. And basically dropped the camera and it was gone.
Skimboarding.
See?
Yeah.